in the name of Jesus, drought in your life, that even when it is physical rainy season, it is still dry season spiritually, financially, and otherwise. I decree and declare, let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain begin to fall.
You're welcome to another spirit-filled message on Christocentric Message. If you're new to this channel, I would entreat you to hit on that subscribe button and then to like this video. As well, I would want you to share this message across, because we believe that as this message is coming forth, it's going to bless you. Your graces are going to be empowered.
Nobody like you, Lord. There's nobody like you.
Sing it, that part that says you hold the universe. Can you sing that part? That's what I want you to hear.
You hold the universe. You hold everyone on earth. Yeah, you hold. You hold the universe. You
choose to believe you. We are men and women who have chosen to trust you. We believe you. We believe your ways. We believe your truth. We are not rebels. We will not argue with your truth. Your word is infallible. It's been tested too many times to be doubted. Lord, tonight we align our hearts to your truth. The truths that make us free, and the truths that can lift us up. We declare in the name of Jesus that that word that upholds all things will uphold our lives. Lord, tonight we submit our hearts to your wisdom. We declare our need for wisdom. We declare our need for wisdom. And Lord, we crave for it. We cry for it. in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Before we sit down, it never gets too much to pray. I just like you to pray just one prayer and say, Lord, I crave for your wisdom. I reckon that I need more of your wisdom, and I crave for it. Like a man seeks for silver, like a man seeks for gold, I crave for your wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing, the Bible says. Therefore, get wisdom. It says, with all thy getting, get understanding. Exalt her, and she shall promote thee. She shall bring an ornament of glory, a crown shall she deliver unto thee when thou dost embrace her. Hallelujah. Please be seated. Good evening, everyone. I never marvel, stop marveling at the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God can turn any man who believes it and walks in that reality into a sign and a wonder. Hallelujah. And I sincerely believe with all my heart that that is why we are here. I come here because I recognize my need for wisdom. I recognize that it is only in his presence, and only when his word is accurately communicated, the principles of the word are accurately communicated, not the information. The information has no power to produce change. You see, let me tell you something. When people do not have faith, it is not because they do not believe God. There is a level of accuracy with which the word of God was designed to be communicated. And if that word is communicated properly, there is a spiritual logic to it that becomes the basis upon which the faith of the people are grounded. Paul said, when I came to you, I did not come with the excellency of speech, he says, but in the demonstration of power, that your faith will not be grounded upon the wisdom of men, Sophia, wisdom that is a product of education, experience, that is limited, suggestions of men, opinions that were based on a very short view. But the Bible says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled. It never said it's settled in the earth, it's settled in heaven. It takes doing what heaven has done to make the word settle in our lives. In the name of Jesus. So I welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. As always, those following us online, thousands of people, we love you, we honor you. Let your hearts be open, let your spirits be open. For those coming here for the first time, this is Koinonia. And we're on a series, Thrive Part 2. Thrive. This is part 2. The series is an attempt to concretize upon our hearts some of the keys that are required for transgenerational relevance, some of the keys that are required for rising above the vicissitudes of life. Like I said last week, it will be irresponsible to pretend that the economic turmoil, the hardship, and all of the things that people are going through, it's not telling on people. You cannot imagine the stories that have emerged as a result of people's frustration. Whenever a people are limited in any way, it will only take time they will react. And oftentimes, they will react based on the informations that they have. So they will use violence, they would do a lot of very stupid things. I've heard of people walking naked for money. I've heard of people giving their children for all kinds of immoral things for money. I've heard of people doing all sorts of things. And the truth about it is that except you are shielded with revelation, you will really feel the gravity of what is happening. Institutions are lamenting, churches are lamenting, social organizations, businesses lamenting, the government itself is lamenting. And that means that we have to source for light and life from another dimension, another reality that is beyond the scope of the human experience. Amen. And I started sharing with us last week how that it is possible to rise above these things. I love the song that the worship team communicated. There is victory. Listen, listen. There is no experience of anyone, regardless of what the peculiar experience is, that is worthy enough to disprove the power, the integrity, the glory, and the efficacy of the person and the word of God. Are we together? If I die today of sickness, my dying of sickness will raise a lot of questions among those who love me, those connected to this vision, and several people across the world. But it does not change the fact that God is mighty and it is within his power to heal. Are we together? If you really want to receive from God, you must desist from isolating your singular experience and using it as a template to judge everything the Bible says about God. Because our experiences are limited. The Bible says that we see in part, 1 Corinthians 13. We see in part, therefore we prophesy. Our communications and that which we do is according to our perspectives. This is why I seek him as a matter of life and death. Let it not be that I'm holding on to a perspective that after many years of being convicted by it and leading others to be convicted by it, I discover that I have lived in error and I've communicated the same to people. The Bible says that we be careful so that what we call light be not darkness. After many years of a man's life, you can discover that the very foundation upon which your convictions are built upon is wrong, inaccurate, imbalanced. Are we together? So when we come before his presence, our hearts must be opened. You don't come to God with an opinion, hoping that he agrees with you. When you come to him, your heart is absolutely open. You say, Lord, I am aware of my vulnerability. I'm a product of culture. I'm a product of genetic programming. I'm a product of environmental conditioning. And many of the realities that I've held as true, though popular, though spiritual, may not be consistent with your path. So I come to you with every open-heartedness, trusting that you will build, you will tear down, you will rearrange and bring order to my life. And that's what God is doing in the name of Jesus. Every time you see consistent results in the life of a man, in the life of a people, in the life of a territory, it is because there is something that is done correctly. Whether or not the practitioners are aware of the dynamics of what they are doing. Are we together? Whether or not the individuals can explain in detail what they are doing or not. The moment you see consistent results, regardless of limitations, there are laws, there are principles that are being practiced. Are we together? And I'm going to take it from there. I shared with us a few things, 4 points in all. We took two. I will begin to take from where we left off last week, and then we'll continue. Number one, I told us that the key to rising above the vicissitudes of life, rising above the challenges and the things that hold men crippled spiritually, economically, and so on and so forth, the first key is a genuine encounter with Jesus Christ. The first key to becoming relevant is not being educated. The first key to becoming relevant is not having business acumen. It's not even being a leader. Are we together? It's not any of these things. Success and any kind of impact, a life of notable impact, starts from the health and the quality of a man's spiritual life. Say amen. The measure of your impact through God in the kingdom is directly associated with the genuineness of your hunger, the sincerity of your love for God. While we're away on a ministration in the course of the week, I met a man of God who was at the meeting, and he just came to see me and talk to me. And God did great things and honored himself in the meeting. And the man sat down and he began to weep like a baby. And he said, sir, what is the secret? I don't know how many times people have asked this. What is the secret? And I kept looking at him. And I said, sir, I can bet that you might be disappointed if I tell you. I wish the secret were just fasting and prayer. I wish the secret were just the quality of my word study life. I wish the secret were just that I was anointed. As important as those things are, I told him, if you want me to be sincere with you and you have the heart to receive, the secret to the dimensions that by the grace of God I've been able to access, are we together, is tied primarily to my passion for God and my sincere desire to see Him glorified. My passion for God and my sincere desire to see Him glorified. You've heard me say it, and God knows my heart. I love God more than ministry. I love God more than money. I love God more than anointing. I don't use Him for these things. Never have and never will. I'd rather give up ministry 1,000 times to remain in His presence and to remain in love with Him. I even love Him more than the quest for His presence. This is where I believe many people miss it. Because primarily our motives are corrupted. God for us means many things. For other people, He's just a solution, like a charm, like a genie that you use and invoke His name, invoke His blood, invoke His fire, invoke whatever to get results. You're not going to really host extraordinary results that way. Are we together? A genuine encounter with Jesus that births the fear of God in you, that births love for God and love for humanity. It's not enough to love God. You must love the people He has sent to you. And you must love the body. I love the body of Christ with all my heart. I am part of it. I'm proud to be part of it. I love the body of Christ. I may not agree with every perspective in the body of Christ. I may not hold as part of my conviction every opinion and perspective, but it's too little a reason to not love the body of Christ. I love the body of Christ, regardless of man of God, regardless of denomination, regardless of exploits or setbacks. I genuinely love the body of Christ. Now, let me tell you, when you get to this spiritual state, when you can assume this posture, you are ready to host the grace for transgenerational relevance. Not outside of this condition. The Bible says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, neither has it come into the heart of any man, that which God has in store, not for them that pray, not for them that seek Him, for them that love Him. When a man truly falls in love with God and is addicted with His presence, His life, everything about God becomes an obsession to you. His house, His life, His word, everything, your whole life is poured as a drink offering. Then you are ready to rise above any challenge. I'm telling you, challenges will come upon you. You will rise and shake them off as if they do not exist. Believe me, I know what I'm saying. Are we together? So we discussed that. And I said how that many believers, they may be born again, but they've not had a genuine encounter with Jesus. An encounter that is greater than any circumstance. You know, when people doubt God and turn and insult God to His face over situations and circumstances, Lord, I prayed for tea, You didn't give me tea. I prayed for bread, You didn't give me bread. I prayed for CGPA, I prayed for a job, You are not faithful. And you know, God, if You don't do this, I will backslide. It's because you've not had an encounter. The remedy for that kind of talk is just an encounter. It's not counseling. The remedy is an encounter. There is a way that a man encounters God that you owe Him your allegiance regardless of what happens around your life. Are we together? It's very important. Whether you bless me or not, I'm in love with you to a point of addiction. Whether ministry rises or not, it does not contribute in any way to influencing my love and my appetite for you. Please, I pray that as you listen to me, this will become a reality. That this will not just become a talk from a preacher. You see, when you are pretending certain things in the kingdom, it will only take time. Time does not change anything, but time is a revealer of motives. Time will reveal whether you genuinely love God or not. The second thing we said that is the key, and I'll pick up from here now, that's where we left off last week, is the power of mental transformation. The second key that is required to rise above and beyond the challenges in life, listen please, to rise above the limitations that plague mankind, to rise to a life that is of notable transgenerational relevance, a degree of kingdom impact that outlives you if Christ tarries, the power of mental transformation. Listen, I said it never tires me to communicate to God's people the extent to which the quality of their paradigm can determine the course of their future in ministry, in life, in business, in marriage, in any area at all. The quality of your mindset. Are we together? And I told us last week that we are conditioned in two ways, basically. The first condition is a genetic programming. We are programmed genetically by reason of the transfer of traits. I'm being very slow and being very detailed because I want us to get this. The second, which is the most disastrous or most notable of the transformations, is environmental programming. Say environmental programming. We are programmed environmentally, which can be engineered by culture, past experiences, our levels of exposure, the environment that we grew up in. Chances are that if you never saw a successful person growing up, you do not have a reference. You see, belief is based on a reference. Are we together? You cannot believe vaguely. There must be a reference, preferably a physical living reference that becomes a standard and the platform upon which your convictions are built. This is why the disciples were very powerful. Jesus was a reference. And that's why every leader that must teach people, part of the assignment of every leader is not only to communicate his persuasions, but to be a reference of the same. It is easy for people to believe when there is a measure, when a leader is in different ways reference worthy, it becomes easy for individuals to connect. When a man is teaching about the anointing and there is some degree of the demonstration of the power and the grace of God upon his life, it becomes easy for the listeners to be persuaded by that dimension. Are we together? It is very difficult, listen, it is very difficult to persuade people over a reality that your life cannot be a reference of. No matter how little the reference is, that it is worthy of conviction. The same thing I am teaching now, I am going to be teaching it 10, 15 years to come. But it will be more impactful than it is now, because by that time my life will be a higher reference than it is now. The same way some of the things I'm sharing now were the things that I shared a number of years past, but their impact were not as impactful as it is now. Of course, I've grown in the anointing, but also there have been maybe a few evidences here and there that can back up and support that communication. Communicating a dimension of spiritual reality or a dimension of any reality that does not have your life as a commendable reference is very frustrating. This already is a lesson for someone that if you want to change your world, the first key is to change yourself. That you become a template enough. People are not that hardened. People are only obsessed with results. It is God that sees the heart. Men look at the outward appearance. They want to see that if you are teaching on divine health, there is a measure of that reality at work in you. If you are teaching on kingdom wealth and prosperity, there is a measure of that reality. If you are teaching on leadership or excellence or dimensions of kingdom reality, there is a level of persuasion that stems from your own experience. Are we blessed tonight? The power of mental transformation. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 9, it says, receiving the end of your faith. We discussed that last week. It said, even the salvation of your soul. The salvation of your soul. Bringing your soul through the renewal of your mind to a point where it can host the realities that are resident within your spirit. I began to discuss with us, and we've done this over different series as we've discussed through the years, the power of paradigms. Look at me. Listen, let me tell you something. As great as a man is, he can limit God. Remember our scripture that has become an anthem in this place, Psalm 78 verse 41. They limited the Holy One. They limited the Holy One. They limited the Holy One. They said, can God make a table in the wilderness? They limited the Holy One. It was not their fault, it was their conditioning. After 430 years of servitude with no hope of deliverance, it was understandable that such a people, as a corporate entity, can doubt God. Something about our culture, as good as it is, something about our cultural experiences have informed us, has created an understanding in our minds. I was talking to a dear friend today who came over to see me, and we were discussing certain things. He was along the side of the line of marriage and all of that, and I was sharing with him, you know, generally speaking, you know, we got into different discussions, and I was telling him that if I were to counsel an intending couple, I'm not going to waste time asking a lot of useless and vague questions. The first thing I want to examine is their passion for God. And then the next thing, I want to examine the extent of their compatibility in terms of their understanding. What is your viewpoint about God? What is your viewpoint about money? What is your viewpoint about your assignment and purpose? What is your viewpoint about your personal life? What is your viewpoint about external influences in your life and home? This does not just apply to the line of marriage, it applies to everything. There is something culture taught us about God. There is something our well-meaning pastors and preachers told us about God. Their experiences were their sermons. They preached it with confidence. We embraced it with sincerity. And we are victims of their limitations. Are we together? There's something that our past experiences have done. I always give an example. If it took someone 10 years to get admission, and you teach on favor, it will take an extra anointing for that person to understand that message. Are we together? Because there is no template that represents favor in his life. Most of our families live from hand to mouth. So every time we talk about prosperity, our minds go straight to the people they insulted and the way they insulted them. We have associated prosperity with negativism, with fraud, with unseriousness, with fetish, demonic activities, especially when young people are prosperous. And you know, let me tell you something. After listening to a very powerful message, after listening to a powerful series, Financial Dominion, The Wealthy Place, The Economic System of the Kingdom, you will think that your paradigm will change at once. No, it took a long time for it to be built. It will take a repetition of new ideas are the keys to changing our paradigms. You have to bring forth those new ideas again and again. That's why the Bible says faith cometh by hearing, and hearing, the next word hearing there is understanding. Hearing and understanding what you hear by the word of God. Hallelujah. Proverbs tells us, for as he thinketh in his heart, for as he thinketh in his heart, for as he thinketh in his heart, it didn't say so he will become. It didn't say so he is becoming. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. For as he thinketh in his heart, it equates my physical reality to my life. This is the difference, hear me brothers and sisters, between a CEO who is living in an office with an AC, having secretaries and PAs, and sitting down, and you think he's just writing. And then a megad, a security person who is opening and closing gates in anger and frustration.
Most times a security person is angry. How can I be working so hard and I'm receiving 10,000 per month and someone is there just writing and he's receiving 500,000? And my answer to that frustration is what? Switch them. Switch them for only 2 weeks. Take the Megad. Don't change anything. Don't give him any orientation. Keep him in that office and take the CEO to the gate. Let me tell you what will happen after 2 weeks. People will stop going to the office. The CEO will do something to that gate that will make the customers remain there. Are we together? His hospitality, his open-heartedness, his calmness, his people skills, and all of these other factors that are important for success will compel the people to love him and remain there. Let's go to our man in the office. I know what he will be doing. Drinking all the juice in the fridge as fast as he can, because something about his mind tells him you are certainly not going to be here for a long time. Then he looks for what to steal. He signs documents anyhow, and then he crosses his leg watching TV, changing channels, enjoying the AC, probably texting all the people and say, my life has changed. The place will be dirty. I assure you, he will not empty the waste bin. He doesn't have that frame of excellence. His paradigm of excellence is not that way. He will destroy everything. He will misplace documents, scatter them, and wonder why they are arranged accurately. At the end of it, he will be frustrated. He will steal something sizable and run away. That will be the end of that man. Another popular example. You wore a shirt for 1 year. It was always clean and ironed. Nobody knew it was 1 year old. And you gave somebody, and his mindset rubbed off on the shirt. In 1 month, he turned a white shirt to brown. Have you seen people like that? Yeah. Listen, our physical environment is but a looking glass. You never change your physical reality by arguing and trying to change things. It's not even by trying to dress well. No. It's a culture. You've got to change your mind. So the Bible says in Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5, permit this mind to be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I was not born this way. I re-engineered myself using the word of God and following those who through faith and patience have obtained the promise. Are we together? You must be disloyal to any understanding and paradigm that has given demon spirits access points to destroy your life. Hallelujah. Paradigms. There are people who will use a water system toilet, a very clean toilet, and finish. I mean, in a house, not even the one in the hostels. A clean toilet. They enter the bathroom, they saw everything clean. They use it and leave it there and just go out smiling. And they tell you, I've finished. They took their mindsets there. Their mindsets took them there. Are we together? Yeah. There is something about excellence, as obvious as it should be, you must be trained to discern it. Don't ever assume that because your mindset has changed, it is so. That's the reason why the higher you rise, the more you must have a greater capacity for patience. Because when your mindset changes, you wonder. Sometimes I look at people and I am amazed the way they think. Certain things that should be so obvious, you are wondering how their mindset can veer off and give them such suggestions. The power of paradigms. Are we together? A man can come to you. Someone can come to a Jimmy, for instance, and sit down and look at him and look at his house and see how God has blessed him. And then just look at him and say, sir, don't be offended. Anything for the boys? And you are wondering. You have access to a great man. What is there to say, sir? If you were to be at my age, what will you advise me to do? Or if you would be at my level in life, what two things do you think I should focus on now? We never ask questions. Have you seen people who have access to great men? One guy came to my hotel room in Abuja, and he came just because of his friend. He wouldn't even come. He came there because of someone like a mentor to him, who is my friend. They came to greet me. When they said hello, we're discussing. I served them myself. I'm telling you, before anybody picked the thing, the guy carried the something and opened it and was taking it. Whereas the person, his mentor, now kept quiet and was listening. You see why that guy is his mentor? Are we together? There is a logic to people's frustration. You can trace it and see why they are where they are. Paradigms, mindsets. Why should I dress well? Am I rich? Paradigm. Are we together? There are people praying endlessly to have pot belly. Just like that. Why? Because based on certain cultural experiences. Now listen, I'm not being sarcastic. I'm teaching here. There are cultures, am I right? That train people. The moment they see you with some level of weight, they say, things are working. But you know that absolutely nothing is working. Paradigms. That's what informs people to live fake lives. There are people who, if God blesses with 50,000 now, their mindset tells them, look, you need to do something around you to make people believe you belong. So they run away and blow up everything, and they come to people. And you see, sometimes, let me tell you something. When I meet people who are greater than me, I have no pressure to prove any point because I know I'm stupid when I'm doing it. But then you see a lot of people with their little understanding, small results here and there, they come and they never learn. They are trying to impress you. Hey, Jimmy, I'm a business person. I just read Robert Kiyosaki's book and you are watching his ignorance. That act alone is a revelation of where you are. Because great people are silent. Let her works speak for her at the gates. And so when we're done, let me finish up my story. They were about to go. I was greeting them, you know. And then the gentleman just came to me and said, sir, please, just one favor. I said, what is it? He said, let me snap with you. And I looked at him. I said, this boy is not wise, honestly speaking. That's why we must crave for wisdom. I said, this guy is not smart one bit. I said, all right, that's okay. He snapped with me. About 3 hours later, my friend called me and said the guy posted the picture on Facebook that me and my very good friend, Apostle Joshua Selman. Now, hold on. I'm not insulting him. He may even be listening now. Listen. Listen. Do you know that gentleman thinks it's by snapping with me so that every other person around, look, let me tell you, if a billionaire wears slippers and kaftan and you wear suit and stand close to him, something about you will tell you are not yet ready for this place. If Benny Hinn stands today and I side by side with him and they say colleagues in ministry, even me, I know, God knows, the devil knows that we are not colleagues. They will snap me standing. When you watch the picture, I will be kneeling down. Because the reality of my heart will reflect itself. Amen. Say paradigms. Say mindsets. Say programmings. Something that your parents held was responsible for their limitations, culture, experiences. Are we together? I don't want to be ahead of myself because the third thing I'll be talking about is where we'll dwell today in details. And I trust that God will change our mindsets. Now, let me tell you something. There is nothing God can do about your life, as powerful as He is, if you are not willing to change your mindset. Lord, I want you to bless me. And God says, okay, can you allow me to walk on you? There's nothing wrong with me. God says, all right. So you have it that way. There is a mindset that is responsible for poverty. There is a mindset that has kept many men of God limited in life and ministry. There are certain mindsets that have kept corporate organizations small. Sometimes I wish that I knew the things I've learned in the last 2-3 years, maybe that I knew them 10-20 years ago. I would have been 100 times, without exaggerating, higher than I am now. I pray that you will receive these things and you will believe them. In 1 minute, lay your hand on your head and say, Lord, there is something in my mind that is responsible for my limitations. Please take it out of me. Go ahead and pray. Take it out of me.
take it out of me.
There's something. I grew up in Nigeria, and there is a way. Nigerians are lovely people. They are great people. But there is a faulty paradigm. Take it away from my life. Take it away from my life. I declare my disloyalty to every paradigm, no matter how long I have held it. A paradigm that has stopped me from accessing the anointing. A paradigm that has stopped me from being a leader. A paradigm that has stopped me from being a visionary person. A paradigm that has stopped me from being wealthy.
Hallelujah. Amen and amen. All right, so let's take today's own. The third key. Key number three to rising above recession. Key number three to rising above any kind of limitation is the discovery and the development of your value and your abilities. I'm going to dwell here. There is a lot to talk about here. The discovery and the development of your abilities, your value. I've done a lot of teachings, and I have taught again and again how that a man's relevance, please listen to me, a man's relevance is not based on chance, is not based on some kind of sentiments. The disparity, the stratification between the wealthy, between the great, the anointed, the influential, among many other reasons, primarily is their value. Write this down, please. Your value is a representation of your worth. Your value is a representation of your worth. W-O-R-D. Your value is a representation of your worth based on the solutions you provide, the problems you solve, and the lives you transform. Your value is a representation of your worth based on the solutions you provide, the problems you solve, and the lives you transform. This is the index for measuring a man's value. So when we say a person is valuable, a preacher is valuable, a businessman is valuable, a leader is valuable, please listen to me. We're not necessarily just talking about anything vague or anything fetish. A measure of the perception that people have over you on the strength of the solutions that you provide, on the strength of the problems that you solve, and on the strength of the lives and destinies that you transform. Put it in another way, if you are not providing any kind of solution, if you are not solving any kind of problem, and if you are not contributing to the transformation of the lives and destinies of people, you are not valuable. And hear me, please. Relevance and wealth in the kingdom is built on a reward system. We've said it again and again. Let me just do a recap on it. I'll touch a bit into that. Right? You can get the message, the wealthy place. Write this down. This is the fundamental law that governs wealth and abundance and governs greatness in the kingdom. Our rewards in life, and that reward can be financial, the sense of security, the sense of honor that we receive, whatever it is, our rewards in life will always be in exact proportion to, number one, the demand or the need for what we do. Number one, the demand or the need for what we do. Number two, our ability to do what we do. Number three, the difficulty in replacing us. My relevance in life, my relevance as a man of God is not just tied to God. The demand for what I do, my ability to do what I do, and the difficulty in replacing me.
Let me tell you, when you understand this, you can accurately gauge why you are where you are right now. This is why pastors are wealthy. Listen, pastors think they are wealthy. I was teaching the school of ministry, students, and I said many men of God think they are rich because they are serving God. That's not the reason why people are wealthy. It's based on a law. If I am blessed today, among other reasons, is based on the perception that you and other people around this nation and in certain parts of the world have about me, which is on the strength of what I do, my proficiency in doing it. Are we together? A man of God is not rich because he prayed for the sick. A man of God is rich because he's providing solutions. His solution may be supernatural in origin. The solution may be spiritual. When you connect people to Jesus Christ, you are providing an eternal solution to the predicament of men. And the system of God's economy was designed that every time you dispense value, whether given for free or sold, a reward must come to you. A reward must come to you. The laws are inflexible. You cannot change them. So for as long as there is an anointing upon me to bring people to the place of encounter, for as long as there is an anointing upon me to birth transformation of the minds and destinies, for as long as there is an anointing to birth revival, to bring miracles, signs and wonders, I remain valuable as far as God is concerned and the benefactors. Let me tell you why that is powerful. Much more than business, it is an intrinsic value. Value that is not dependent on any external environment, and value that is rewarded only based on the perception of the benefactors. So one person can bless me with 100 naira as a representation of his comprehension of my value. Another person can bless me with 10 million as his comprehension of the perception of my value. Don't say I am poor. Don't say I am mediocre. What value are you bringing to the table of destiny? Call this stage the table of greatness. There are enough seats for everyone, but your pass is your value. Your pass is your value. Not just any value. Values that are needed and useful. Values that are needed and useful, applicable to the predicament of your generation. God is helping someone. Are we together? What have you brought to the table of greatness that author, listen, do you know why they call people thieves and fraud? Because you see rewards, but you do not see the value that is commensurate to that reward. That's why we hate armed robbers. An armed robber brings a gun and says, give me your 1 million. And you tell him, what is the value? He says, I have no value, but I have a gun to threaten you. So it is bad. But that same 1 million, you will give it to someone who offers a value that is worth it. Listen, you don't sit down and wish to rise. You grow in value to the level that matches what you desire. So Frank Edward ministers, and based on the perception of his value, someone can bless him with 10 million, whereas there is another musician somewhere in Samaru who may be moving around and nobody will bless him. What is the difference? Their value. Your value is a representation of your worth based on your ability. There are two dimensions to value. I want to talk a bit about value. Number one is intrinsic value. Write it down. Intrinsic or inherent value. Value that came with you. It was a gift from God to you. Part of your packaging and part of your wiring. It can be improved upon. Hallelujah. Are we blessed this night? I really want to challenge you. Look at me, please. Please do not trivialize what I'm teaching you. God is not a herbalist. This is the key that lifts men above recession. I was talking to one of our ladies. She works in the bank. And I was talking to her this morning. And I told her, I said, how is it going in the bank? And she said, Kai, things are really bad for many people, though. But she said, there are some. I said, that's right. In my mind, I said, that's me. You are now talking about me. He said, there are some, their lives have increased and multiplied. Do you know the concept of recession is not supposed to apply to an individual? Recession only makes sense when you look at it from a corporate and a territorial perspective. There was famine in Samaria minus the king. Minus the king. Number two, minus Elijah. All the people, Elisha never said, please. Even Elijah begged for bread. Elisha did not beg for bread in Samaria. He came gallantly and saw people eating their children. The other one said, we ate my child yesterday. We said, let's boil this other child, and the woman refused. Are we together? Prophet, we boiled my child yesterday. When I was eating my child, we ate together. Now is the turn to eat her own child, and they refused. And the prophet said, no. Let me tell you something. Your value vetoes your education. Your value vetoes your cultural background. Your value vetoes any limitation. I don't care what it is.
Will you open up the gates? Open up the doors. Will you open up the gates? Open up the doors.
Listen, believe me, brothers and sisters, when I tell you your value vetoes a lot of things. Sunday Adelaja, 96% of his membership in a communist nation. Right? Ukraine, a communist nation, 96% of its members are white. In a communist nation. Value. The key to eradicating a sense of unworthiness is not criticizing great people. This is what a lot of pastors go through. This is what a lot of business people go through. This is what a lot of individuals go through. They think the key is resentment and anger and hatred. No, the key is to pay the price of discovery and developing your value. A student comes in, backtrack 5 years, 6 years, a naive young person, probably in his teenage, comes into an institution. I want to study medicine. Not even having an idea of what he wants to do. Are we together? Or the implication. And he goes through 5, 6, probably 7 years of rigorous training. They never change his skin. They never change his clothes. They only change his mind. And after 6, 7 years, a panel of people will test him and accredit the fact that he is worthy of being called a doctor, and they issue a little piece of paper that becomes his authorization. Value. I am surprised when many people say, why am I poor? What kind of question is that? Why am I poor? Why am I suffering the recession? And I mean no disrespect as I communicate this. Everyone is left to his lot. If Bill Gates, for instance, let me use finances. If Bill Gates comes here right now and says, everybody, go and hold someone whose life you changed. If you can hold 5 people, you receive $1 million. Some of us will roam to everybody. You touch somebody, you say, I will slap you. You've not added any value to my life. Why do you want to hold me? I have never been blessed, not by your wisdom, not by your spiritual life, not by your anointing, not by your academics. Nothing about you has changed me. But there are others, there will not be enough room. Everybody says, you changed me. You changed me. You blessed me. You advised me. My business is flourishing because of the idea you gave me. That sickness in my body left because of the anointing upon your life. The power of your secret place changed my life. You preached a message and brought a dimension that changed me. Problem solved. Solutions provided. Lives transformed. And there is a reward waiting for you. I guarantee you. No witch and no wizard from any village and anywhere has the power and the capacity to stand an individual that has walked upon his value. What is my value? What is my gift? What is that ability that can bail me out? Let me tell you something. And I'm a Nigerian. I want to say something that is very serious right now. I'm a Nigerian. I love Nigeria. I love everyone in this country. We are brothers and sisters. Are we together? But listen. Do you know why? I want to be sincere with you. Do you know why a lot of people are suffering this recession now? I know many people think it's Buhari. Others think it's Jonathan. Other people think it's PDP, APC. I'm not a politician. Are you together? Let me tell you. Something about the nose diving of the oil reveal that we have never truly been valuable as a people. We only receive natural resources and we have been covering it for years. The same way to happen to your destiny. I mean, a department, they give everybody food free of charge. So I think, let me tell you, you do not generalize impact and success. You must be sure what part you are contributing, otherwise you'll be ashamed with time. We are worship team. We are all great. But in all sincerity, what is your unique contribution? One day you hold the mic alone. And on that day, we know that you are the one limiting the worship team. On that day, we know, so that mistake in the keyboard comes from you. We have been managing it, but right now, we are a group of intelligent lecturers. We are all intelligent people. The day you have to do a presentation as a person, life must single you out one day to defend yourself. I belong to an anointed ministry, great and wonderful. We are shaking the world. I agree with you. A day will come, you will stand before the sick. Apostle, I'm not there. Ejimi, I'm not there. My head of department, prayer, ushering, decoration, they are all not there. On that day, that's when you will know whether the impartations you've been receiving or otherwise. Life will challenge you. Life will test it. And until you are able to prove it, the disciples kept enjoying corporate success until one day when Jesus climbed up the Mount of Transfiguration, they were happy. They brought an epileptic person. They said, don't worry about Jesus. We are here. Just keep him down. They struggled. They were embarrassed. Nothing happened. Let me tell you. Do you know what causes jealousy? The ease and the flawlessness that someone who has paid the price to be valuable does on something you have been frustrated about. You've been praying on a sick body and you gave all kinds of reasons. No, this person cannot be sick. Then the person comes for a meeting and even without being prayed for, before the opening prayer, he's healed. And then the person testifies exactly as it happened. You know how people testify? They will say it the way it happened. May God make you to develop an appetite to be valuable. An appetite to be valuable. Let me tell you how you know you are really valuable. When no monetary value placed on you becomes a burden to the giver, you are exceptionally valuable. Listen, listen. I can't remember how much this is, how much they bought it. But let's assume this is 300,000. Just an assumption, right? Assume that this pulpit is 300,000. When they call the price, what do you do? You look at it. The material, the quality. And you say, it's okay. If they look at this and say, bring 10 million, you look at it and say, no. That's the same way they rate you. So you say 20,000, they say you are telling the truth. Then you say 100,000, they say, for where? Is money free like that? But there are others, they don't even say anything. Their value says any amount, priceless, 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 priceless. And so someone brings 10 million and says, sir, Please don't be offended. It's a privilege for me to do this. May you be such a person. May you be such a person. Hallelujah. Benny Hinn is coming to Nigeria, and the plans that have, in fact, to a point that the very ministry that is bringing him does not even have absolute control over his coming again. The Christian bodies have had to come in because they sat and said, no, we are going to come in. Now he's not only ministering in Lagos, he's also going to worry to go and minister in a crusade again. Say value. Yeah. When Benny Hinn enters a nation, no matter who is inviting him, he's received by the ambassador of the America and a presidential delegation. So his coming is not something you wake up and come by mistake. Even if he's strolling, his personality, we call it human capital. My desire is that under God, myself and this great ministry will be so valuable. This place has become like a place of pilgrimage right now. The protocol has had to start making arrangements with hotels around. Why? Because every week groups are coming, individuals are coming from all over the nation. It's called value. If we remain at this level, we will never rise. But if we keep rising by the Spirit of God and through determination, a time will come, somebody will come from another state, another nation, and say it's a privilege, finally. Are you that valuable? Are you that valuable that your absence is an interruption to somebody's life? Are you so valuable? I'm speaking to you from the depth of my heart. Then you will know why certain... The money we are saying has left Nigeria did not disappear. Money is like energy. It can neither be created nor destroyed. It is transferred. So it leaves from the point of no value, passes through the place of small value, and lands in the place of capital value. Say amen. Wanting something for nothing is fraud. Wanting something for nothing is wickedness. Now, let me tell you how many of us approach it. Oh God, will you keep looking at me like this? And God says, I've been looking. I set laws and I put preachers. He said, let them come back to life. Remember the prayer of who? The rich man. Let them come back to life. He said, no, they have the prophets and the law. If they will not listen to them, even if somebody comes back to the dead, they will not listen. Just like there are people God has anointed, but many people will not listen. Why should you fail in life? Your background? Who told you it's because of your background? There are people today with no arms, but they are valuable. There are people with no legs, they are valuable. There are people with no eyes, they are valuable. There are people who cannot speak, they are valuable. We don't love Jesus just because he's the Son of God. He's really valuable. He's an expression of infinite value by every standard. Are we together? Any man can determine his lot in life. Any man can determine his lot in life. Your reward is in exact proportion. But apostle, I'm a graduate and now I'm working. I'm getting 50,000. But now I'm married to a wife and three children. That's the limit of your value. Because your education was never designed to fund your assignment. It was designed to help you. You are only working at the limit of what you know. And if you do not know more, you will remain that way. Hallelujah. Yesterday, one of the protocol, he usually helps me if they need to fix anything in my car. He helps me to fix it. And I was going to drop him, and I decided to just take a stroll with him. I like talking to people. I decided to take a stroll with him and then to turn and come back. And I was talking to him. I said, do you know why you are in this car now? And he looked at me. I said, there are so many people in Zaria. You can drive and you have loyalty and integrity, it's called value. It earned you the right here. When we stop, let me confess, we went to buy suya. Praise God. And so while they were ordering the suya, I made an order of the suya and he was sitting. I said, do you know why you are sitting close to me now? He said, no, sir. I said, value. You are the one who went to fix the car. It gave you the privilege to do it. I told him, do you know why we are not in the filling station now? He said, no. He said, because the tank is full. The day it finishes or gets more, we will need the filling station. Are we together? Why have I not come to you? Why have I not called you? You don't call me. Why should I? Why should I? You are proving as if I'm nothing. You made yourself so. There is a way you make yourself. There are people who cannot even pick calls. There are others who are angry. Aaron, I don't like what you are doing. Harper, is it because God has lifted you now? You left us. That's always what they say. I intend to rise. Whoever intends to rise with me, then we move together. I cannot love you so much to be so loyal and keep myself low. I'm telling you why many of us are offended with so many people. Offended, my friend. We used to eat together, but you were not doing the same thing. Now the person has risen. You call the person and a secretary picks. Hello, sir, so organization. Please, let me talk to him, Jare. Tell him my name is Ajayi. You don't know me again. And you are shouting and raking and getting angry. May God make you so valuable. Listen to me. May God make you so valuable that your value transcends territories. Because there are values that are only, there are people, that's what we call local champion. One who is valuable within a territory. And so when you step out to another territory, you are as inert as somebody whose potential is not at work. But there are certain people, even celebrity musicians, even if they step out by mistake, everybody is snapping them, they have to run. Now, they may be going to hell. Are we together? But as far as value is concerned, generally speaking, they are communicating value. It's just the content of their music that is demonic. Their vocal training is excellent to a fault. Now you come on stage and you say, I want to rise. What are you called into? I'm called into the music ministry. Really? Yes. What have you done so far? I've been, you know, a gentleman came and met me one time and he came and said that he's looking for sponsors. I said, what for? That he wants to produce an album. I said, who is mentoring you? He said, nobody. I said, can you play any instrument? He said, no. I said, who has ever approved, genuinely approved of your music? He said, no. I said, I'm not going to help you. I'm really helping you by not helping you, because I'm helping you realize the mistake fast.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me.
Listen, can't you see that this is God's bailout system? I came from a background where we were living in a hut with mud. The mud is not in your mind. The mud is not in your mind. Jesus was born in Nazareth. They said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He broke that limit. Stop giving excuses. Make up your mind from today. There is something my world can celebrate. Years ago, when I was staying in a little room, praying and reading books, all my money went to buying books. Buy the truth and sell it not. God, you have given me grace for music and worship. Who can invite me because of the grace I carry? Don't flatter yourself in mediocrity. Challenge yourself based on a reference that is global. Don't flatter yourself. You make mistakes, you sing off key, and someone says, Kai, you know, Elijah, this is fantastic. You say, really? No, you didn't do well. You didn't do well. We were glorified because of the anointing, but vocally speaking, you didn't do well. This lack of preparedness is what makes people to mock themselves. Any competition they hear around, they will come. Have you seen people like that? And they say, why are you here? Say, I'm here to win. And you watch your competitors, just by looking at them, you see the flawlessness of their preparation. And just the preliminary screening, you are back home. And then you say, no, in Nigeria, this is because this person is Yoruba. That's why they didn't take me. No, sir, you are not good. Be honest with yourself. I'm not saying you cannot be good. Listen, value is only valuable when competence is added to it. Value only becomes valuable when competence is added to it. Yesterday I was studying on diamonds. I just decided to study on diamonds. I didn't know that there were different kinds of diamonds, different kinds. And I was seeing the diamonds and the rigor in finding them. And I mean their structure, the precision of their structure is what makes them valuable. Are you competent? Are you competent? Seest thou a man diligent in his ministry, diligent in his business? It's only a matter of time. You may be soaking garri now, but diligence is like a plane. It will lift you beyond the limitations. It can be raining and you just take a flight, and within 1 minute you are already out of that rain. You are not even aware that it's raining again until you land. Koinonia, I'm challenging you. I will be a wicked preacher. I will be a wicked man of God to not challenge you in the area of value, because that's what I'm doing with my life. And by the grace of God and in all sincerity, that's what has brought me where I am. And I told you, where I am now is my preparation of yesterday. Tomorrow will reveal to you what I'm doing today. Value always precedes manifestation. So when you see a man manifest, that's not his true state. It is his passive state based on your seeing him now. In business, in ministry, there are many pastors who don't know how this thing works, and they may never find out. There are many people who don't know how this thing works. I'm sorry to say, but look at Zari as a case study. Almost every business in Zaria, almost, not all, but almost every business in Zaria is tainted by mediocrity, smallness, average. There's nothing world class. There's no touch of excellence in it. We are limited because of our culture. I have my small shop. This is nice. We never learn. Someone has paid the price and made the mistake for you. Then you make it again. No, you must learn from other people's mistakes. Are we together? I have hardly seen things in this city, and I say it with all humility, that have impressed me to know that this is at a level of a global repute. From our hotels, are we together, to our restaurant services. In fact, from the most part, they are terrible. Yet there are many of us seated here. If I ask you now, what did you say? I've been cooking. You are the only one who has not eaten. The fact that I've not eaten your food means nobody has recommended it. And that means they've been flattering you by saying it's sweet. If food is delicious, we are not stupid people. Jimmy's wife makes cakes. Everybody knows. She's not necessarily done any great marketing. Let her works speak for her at the gates. What is so exceptional about what you do? What do you do that will make me feel like I am losing a lot if I don't partner with you? Everybody say competence. Say it, competence. Say it again, competence. Listen, if you pay attention to what I'm saying, you will reap an endless benefit. Favor then is when preparedness. The day God wants to bless you, he will station your destiny helpers close to you. Men and women who have the perception and the strength to reward your value. And then he says, now you have prepared yourself. There are too many. You know the problem with many of us? Look at me. This pressure for recognition. I want to know that I'm a CEO. I said it, I think it was to the School of Ministry students. People write books after 10, 20 years of a track record. But in Nigeria, people write books to start up what they are doing. So someone who has nothing writes 81 keys to the billionaire lifestyle. A book is an authorization for men to listen to you based on a result that is obvious in your life. You are documenting your persuasion to create a track for people to follow. Years ago, they are not really my friends, but they are ministers too. They met me and said, Apostle, at your level, there are some bishops who are not like you. You should be on TV and radio. I said, I hear. So that I will get to a point where I'm limited and I have to beg for partners. Isaiah 77, give me Isaiah 61, give me 61 naira or 610 naira. I don't want to do all those things. I don't want to stand on airplane gimmicks. I want a situation where the day Koinonia comes on air, someone will say, this is what I've been looking for. I have a business that is producing $10 million every month. I've been looking for a ministry to sponsor. This is it. Solutions provided. Problems solved. Lives transformed. And you enter your Sabbath at once. Please hear me, Koinonia, and all those following. Not everybody is a victim of this recession. I tell you the sincere truth from the depth of my heart. I say it with all humility and not in any boastful way. I say it with all humility and not in any boastful way. The finance of this ministry has skyrocketed in a way and a dimension that is irrecoverable this year, more than any year put together. Now, please, I'm sorry if it looks like I'm boasting. I'm only challenging you. In a time we call recession, say something I do not know. Say it again. Something I do not know may be responsible for my limitation. One of my pastor friends started bus transport, bus services, and he called me. He said, Apostle, I can't believe this. You've been transporting people on bus services and we're not so much in our church. Just at one junction where everybody will wait. After 1 month, we looked at when they sent the report. I said, nobody, a trek from wherever you are coming. And we've done this without fail. Not for Friday's program. Anytime this ministry is holding any program, once it is night, we're a responsible ministry. At any time, whether it was planned or not. Brothers and sisters, there is something that is being done. This is where I'm taking you to. It was not like that. Our first crusade, they were almost locking me because of 150,000 Aaron. Whereas the money that is circulating now was still there. I have learned through pain. I have learned through mistakes. I've learned through mentorship, and you are receiving it for free. I pray that you will treasure it, and I pray that it will lift you higher than ever. Some of you are about to get married. You know you are not ready. Are we together? You already know, not by revelation, by wisdom, that your wife is going to suffer. You know that your children are going to suffer. How do I know that? There is no plan. Dotham became mighty because he prepared his way before the Lord. You are not preparing your way. There can't be greatness. Don't be too quick to show forth. Prepare. Everybody say prepare. Prophesy to yourself. Say myself. Prepare. Myself. Be competent. Myself. Work on yourself. Don't make noise. Don't take this colleague mentality moving around. I used to know you, Pastor Femi. We are fellow pastors. Colleague mentality is the key to the undoing of many people. Oh, we were classmates, the same class, the same university, the same this. We are both doctors, we are both professors. No, no, no. The Bible says one star differed from another in glory. Say in the name of Jesus, there is an ability. Say there is a gift within me that is greater than Zaria, greater than Nigeria. There is an intrinsic value within me that can bless me, that can bless the kingdom, and I will search it out. Hallelujah. There is an intrinsic value. Now, intrinsic value has to do with value that is inherent. The only thing you do is to develop it, is there. I'll give you an example. Intellectual property is an intrinsic value. You don't refrigerate it, you don't warm it, you don't keep it in a safe, in a bank. It's there, it's there. You've trained your mind, intelligence, intellectual property is there. He's playing this keyboard now. This is intrinsic value. It's value within him. Value that does not depend on the external environment for its performance. Are we together now?
Yeah.
A photocopying machine is not an intrinsic value. The machine needs a demand. The machine needs a lot of things. The machine needs light. Are we together? The greatest way to rise is to work first on your intrinsic value. You have the grace to sing, work on it. You are an entrepreneur, work on it. Don't say I'm a CEO. CEO that is not producing results is a sign to sit down. Say I'm a potential CEO. There are people moving all around with complimentary cards and flattering themselves. I am this and that and that. I'm into real estate, agro, allied products, and so on and so forth. We have branches in Ghana, Benin Republic, Port Harcourt, Lagos, and so on and so forth. And you look at the person who is talking. You ask him, sir, what do you know about real estate? Say, look, that's not the most important thing. Me, I'm telling you, my father did it. He gave me, and he has one plot of land somewhere. You see, we mock ourselves. Packaging is only meaningful when there is content. Packaging is only meaningful when there is content. Packaging without content is like a balloon. You hold a balloon and claim that the balloon is a metal. You will just touch it and it will burst. I sing better than many people who are called into the music ministry. Yet, they want me to buy their album. No. I told you last week, there are many people who claim they can cook. They have restaurants. Are we together? And you start bullying people and say, ah, shouldn't you come and eat in my restaurant? I saw you the other day. Ella, you should come to my restaurant to eat. Are we not fellow Koinonia people? She wants to be healthy. She wants to be healthy. And as far as it is concerned, you have not worked on yourself. One of our school of ministry ladies, she made one beautiful work, just a beautiful artwork. The students saw it. I mean, she's here. Very fantastic artwork. And when I saw it, I said, my goodness, this is excellent. I told her, improve yourself and monetize your value. Monetizing your value is the last thing you do when it is flawlessly competent. Then you place a price on it. Are we together? Now, I want everybody to write. Write three things you know God has put in you that must be developed and deployed. Please write it down. Young, old, write it down. Type it, write, do whatever it is. Please write it down. Don't flatter yourself. Don't write what you don't have. Just patiently think and you'll find your own. Don't just write because your neighbor wrote something. Value. Value. Aaron is here. He handles most of the logistics of the, you know, people around, different kinds of logistics. Why? Because he's worked on himself and he's still working on himself. The other day I went to his house and I saw a blackboard close to his just a little like dining or thereabout, and his little office that he has, and I saw him writing goals. I saw targets. I saw plans of action. I said, this is excellent. this person is going to go far. Please do not think discovery simply means it is worthy of reward. That you have discovered a thing does not mean they will reward you. It must be developed to the highest level of excellence and then communicated with integrity, communicated with discipline, and communicated with the anointing. Hallelujah. I met a pastor, and the pastor told me something. He said, man of God, he's quite an elderly man. He said, if you continue going the way you are going, you're going to have such an exceptional ministry. I said, thank you, sir. I intend to. And that's why I seek people like you to add to my life. I am not ashamed of my ignorance. I'm not ashamed of my limitations and the thing that I do not know. There are many things I do not know. I know some, but there are many others. If I knew them, I would not be where I am. And I humble myself to seek for knowledge. I see the way people trivialize knowledge and trivialize the sacrifices of others. Are we together? You call somebody you perceive to be valuable, and then you tell the person, when can I come and meet you? Or when can you come and meet me? And the person says, why? You say, I have a business proposal. I want us to rub minds together. Sit down with your broke, bad attitude, and you will never rise. Never rise. There's so many people who do that. Why am I challenging you? I want you to rise beyond the recession. You've heard the testimonies of people. This money has not flown anywhere. This greatness has not flown anywhere. The concept of recession to an individual is a mirage. Hear me. Please hear me. I understand business. I'm not daft. I'm not stupid. I know what I'm saying. The concept of recession is not supposed to be explained from an individual platform. It is when you look at the economy territorially, societally, then you can say, based on the GDP of a nation, based on certain indices, a nation, when it does not meet certain things, then there is a recession, there is inflation, or whatever it is. But not an individual. There has been no time in the Bible where famine affected everybody. There has always been exemption. Those who offer value are the ones who are exempted. Please hear me. What gives you the justification that between today, Friday, and next Friday, something would have entered your hand? Or I'm not necessarily just saying money. Somebody would have acknowledged the fact that God is using you to bless him. My life has been transformed. What value do you have? You see, the anointing does two things. It activates something within you that was not there and amplifies something within you that is there. It activates something within you that was previously not there, or introduces, a better word, introduces something within you that was not there, like the healing grace, right? Like revelation, the capacity, utterance. But then it also amplifies something within you that is there, like creativity, like leadership, like your gift. So number one, your encounter with God that produces a fear of God in you. Number two, a transformed mind. Transform beyond your cultural limitations. Number three, the discovery and the development of your abilities, your value. Please do not forget this. Greatness, wealth, any kind of achievement in the kingdom is based on a reward system. It's not just the issue of the will of God. The issue of the will of God, as far as our greatness is concerned, is not a mystery. It is clear in the word. I know the thoughts that I think towards you, said the Lord, Jeremiah 29 and the 11th chapter. Thoughts of good and or peace and not of evil, to bring you a future and an expected end. Deuteronomy 28 from verse 1. it shall come to pass if thou shalt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord, to do and observe all that I commanded this day, right? That you shall be exalted above all the nations of the earth, and this blessing shall come upon you and overtake you. There is always a part you have to play. There is a part that I have to play. Huh? Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. This book of the law, it says, shall not depart from out of thy mouth. It says, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do all that is written therein. Then he says, then, only then, shall thou make thy way prosperous, and you shall have good success. Success that does not steal away the time of your family. Success that does not steal away your life. Are we together? Give me 5-10 minutes. Let me talk a little. Let me take point three a little more. Write this down, please. I know that I've taught a lot about finances, but let me just talk for 5-10 minutes on a few things about our financial life. Number one, let me tell you something. A job alone will limit you. I want to expand your horizon and work on your creativity a bit. A job alone will limit you. Brothers and sisters, no matter how much of a job you get, no matter how great of a job you get, a job does not have the capacity to fund your assignment. Your needs are plenty. Family needs. The average African family has siblings that are looking up to you for assistance. It's capital intensive to live in Nigeria, to send children to school. Almost all of us here, by the time you are a Christian and you are born again, you have commitments to your church, to your group, to your ministry. And part of it is financial commitment. Part of it, there are several things you have to do that take money from you. You are broke. Let me give us a little financial intelligence. We'll always add this. You are broke anytime your inflow is far, far less than your outflow. You will always, without fail, be on deficit. 1 naira comes into your life, you need 4 naira to go out of your life. You will be in trouble. You will have to be in trouble. You cannot be earning 50,000 naira, probably 100,000, and believe that in itself, you remove tithe, you remove a lot of things. It is just not enough. That's the challenge with our parents. 100,000 was enough when they had one child. Now they have 5 children, but their finances have not increased. So it's pinning them and straining them to death. Are we together? What then is the solution? Activate other streams of income. 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 Don't sit down running around and say there's no job. And I don't mean don't do small, mediocre things that waste your time, your energy, your money, and then at the end, nothing comes out from it. Activate streams of income. Work on your mindset. Monetize your intrinsic value that is being developed. You will rise above recession, I tell you. Are we together? Did you know, for instance, every week we rent chairs in the dozens. During the miracle service, we rent thousands of chairs in the dozens. That's someone's business. Are we together? That's someone's business. Every week, there are things only in this ministry alone that can make an individual a millionaire if he knows how to create a system around that value and supply it. Just Koinonia alone. Please activate streams of income. Take responsibility for your life and don't give people anything substandard. You are insincere and you are ungodly when you whet the appetite of people over a value you know you cannot offer. Don't be that insincere. Make sure that you have worked on yourself and you are competent enough. Then you can open up your hands for value. Don't collect a contract to help somebody roof his house and then you roof nonsense. No, don't do that. If you know you cannot work on it, package yourself. Work on yourself. I work on myself every day. I returned back from my trip yesterday. As tired as I was, I made sure that my daily goals were met. Please, don't you think that it is just the anointing? The anointing is there. I'm going to talk about it. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. He said, but this grace was not showered upon me in that I labored more than ye all. I prepare an average of 2 to 3 sermons every week. It takes time. It takes research. It takes staying in the spirit. There are other aspects of my life I am involved in. What are you doing? There is no laziness. Don't sit down and say, oh God, when will you change my situation? Don't sit down and say, who will come and marry me out of this problem? Nobody. At least nobody in Koinonia. And brothers, don't wait and say, which lady? Bible says, he that finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Are we together? This is the undoing of Africa. This is the undoing of many people. My neighbors, they bought a few months ago, they bought a grinding engine. And the moment they bought that grinding engine and stationed there, at once they became relevant in that environment. Almost all the houses within that environment no longer enter a car and go to Samaru to go and grind beans or whatever. They come to them. What is their reward? The transportation of everybody who should go there now comes to them. A place that was previously very quiet and conservative, now you see the people. Early in the morning, the engine is up and they are grinding, sometimes till late in the night, and they are making money from it. Please, I want you to go back and sit down and be sincere with yourself, young and old. Sit down and say, I now see why things are not working in my life. I now see why I'm feeling the heat of the recession. I am not saying you should be a money monger. Remember, we've done financial dominion. So you cannot sit down and say, now, which business do I do? That's a wrong question. How do I develop myself to rise to a point of value? When you are valuable, then now you build a system around that value. That's what we call business. Business is simply the art of packaging your value that has been developed to serve a targeted people. Then you receive financial rewards, among other things. There's nothing mysterious about business. Building a business is simply having a value, converting it to a product or a service that is needed and useful, and then creating a system that informs your potential customers of what you have to give. Very simple. But it's not as simple as it sounds. The last point. Rise to a point of value. Rise to a point of value. The last point. What is the fourth key to becoming transgenerationally relevant? The fourth key to rising beyond recession. We name the series Thrive. To thrive does not mean to manage. To thrive means to blossom. Thrive gives a picture of a plant growing out. You see how a plant grows out of the soil, and you see it moving regardless of the strength of the soil. It shoots through it and it blossoms. That's what it means to thrive. You don't thrive if there are no obstacles. You thrive in spite of obstacles. The fourth key is an encounter with the anointing. Anointing.
Anointing. Fall on me, anointing. Fall on me. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me. anointing fall.
Sing it one more time, everybody.
Anointing fall on me. Anointing.
Let the power of the Holy Ghost.
Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me.
I love what I'm about to share with you. I'm telling you, because it's something that has changed my life. You see the amazing dimension of God when you understand the anointing.
You are amazing, dear. You are amazing. You are amazing. You are amazing. Oh, oh, oh.
Anointing. The anointing. Write this down. Let me give you a few definitions about the anointing. Kabrati sele karasunda brahatari adabalada.
You are amazing, yeah. You are amazing. You are amazing. You are amazing.
Write this down. The anointing is God's seal of authorization to represent Him in your territory. The anointing is God's seal of authorization. It's His authorization upon an individual to represent Him. The authorization for legislature, the authorization to represent God and to represent heaven on earth, the anointing. Number two, the anointing is the capacity to produce change and compel compliance. The capacity to produce change and compel compliance. Psalm 66 verse 3. How terrible art thou in thy ways. Through the greatness of thy power shall thy enemies submit themselves to you. To compel compliance. Number three. Now I love this definition. The anointing is an empowerment to manifest the possibilities in God. An empowerment to manifest, to reveal, to make known the possibilities that are resident in God. There are possibilities in God. It's a slogan that we use here. Experience possibilities. I think the media should do a montage on this. Experience possibilities. It's a slogan we have come to not just recite but believe. We've indoctrinated ourselves with the fact that there are limitless possibilities in God, and those limitless possibilities can find expression to the degree to which the unction, the grace of God is at work upon the life of an individual. The Bible is a compendium, an unfolding of the possibilities that are resident in God, revealed from generation to generation. Hallelujah. I got a testimony recently, and I'm sure they may be following online, and they sent it to me so I can share it in the open. When we went to Yola for the last crusade a month or two ago, we went to Yola. One of the person who was driving me around is a doctor, PhD, you know, with his wife. He's been married and they've been, I mean, no child. This thing has not worked for them. And he decided that he was going to drive me around as a seed. You know, it's been a while they've been married. They're probably following now. And his wife couldn't take him. And, you know, when they were done, we're about to leave, I asked him, I said, what would you want the Lord to do? And then prayed for them. And he sent me a text. I think it was on our way to Bauchi now. It was on our way to Bauchi. I just got a text. He said, Apostle, the text is still on my phone. He said, I called to tell you that my wife went to the hospital and they said, I think she's 3 or a month pregnant. Say results. Shout it. Listen, results are evidences that God is alive. Not just an evidence that a man is anointed. It's much more than that. It's much more than that. It's much more than that. During our dinner, we'll be playing some videos. I hope that the media would consider that. I don't know what their plans are, but I hope that they should incorporate that. And one of the things that we're going to be doing is playing clips and showing you a few pictures of some of the external ministrations. And some of you will marvel and wonder at the hand of God and what he can do when a man is anointed. I've said it and I will say it again and again. The anointing does not make the difference. The anointing is the difference. How can the anointing make a difference when it is the difference? It is the very difference. When all is said and done, the grace that comes upon the life of a man. I have found David my servant, and with my holy oil I have anointed him, and the enemy shall not exert upon him. And then he reads on and he says, and in my glory shall his horn be exalted. Listen, let me tell you something. I have come to respect the anointing not because of what it has done in my life alone, but this ministry, you see, is a place of possibilities. The testimonies, the tearful testimonies that have come, and it's not just because of Joshua Selman. Take the anointing out of my life and I'm as empty as this chair, you see. Are we together? Someone's life is going to be changed because of the anointing. Someone's life will rise because of the anointing. Listen, after you've worked on your gift needs to be anointed. It's one thing to be gifted, but is your gift anointed? It says the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, but candle without fire on it cannot give illumination. Are we together? There is an anointing that can come upon you and change the dimension of your entrepreneurial exploits, and you will see things happen that you never believed. There is an anointing that can come on you and your academic career just skyrockets in a way and a dimension. There is an anointing that can come upon your music ministry. So much more than the vocal competence and your work, you lift a voice and sing a song, and that song becomes somebody's healing. That song becomes someone's. I was watching a video today, Covenant Christian Center, and I was watching their leadership, their summit that they hold, their yearly summit, and I was listening to some speakers, and while they were talking, I said, my God, these guys are not just business moguls, they are absolutely anointed. Absolutely anointed. Are we together? Thou anointed my head with oil. You did not anoint my cup, you anointed my head, but that anointed translated to my cup overflowing. There is a relationship between what is on your head and what flows from your cup. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. In 2 Kings chapter 4, the wife of the son of the prophet went to Elisha. And Elisha said, what do I need to do to you? What is wrong? What is the problem? And she said, you know, this and that, there is this situation. And then he says, what do you have in your house? And she said, nothing thy handmaid had nothing except a little cruse of oil. And he said, that's it. He said, go and borrow vessels. Verse 3. Go and borrow vessels from all your neighbors. He said, borrow not a few. Borrow not a few. If you increase capacity, every oil assumes the shape of the container that holds it. If I pour this water on the cover, listen, if I pour this water on the cover will limit the water. This makes this water look as though it is triangular. Pour it in a plate, the plate will become like that. Thank you. Are we together? The anointing. And then when she got it, he now told her, he said, go and close the door. When the prophet was talking, the anointing is a living thing. It was hearing. It was hearing the discussion. And the moment she did that, she began to pour the oil. The oil began to multiply. Listen, it's not enough to be anointed. You must be anointed at a level that can command notable results. It's not enough to be anointed. The anointing is like currency. The anointing is like currency. 100 naira can buy sweet, but 100 naira cannot buy shoe. But it is still money. So don't say I'm anointed. The Bible says, Acts chapter 10, right? When Paul was speaking in the house of Cornelius, the salvation of the Jews, in verse 38, he said, how God anointed. Look at the extent to which God anointed Jesus. So it's not just that Jesus was anointed. Look at the extent. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. And then the Bible says, on the strength of that anointing, he went about doing good and healing all they that were oppressed of the devil. Why? For God was with him. The anointing is not an instrument to shake and fall down and roll. No. Those are just effects of the anointing on the human body. And then alongside with other spiritual dynamics that happen at the point of impartation. But the proof that a man is anointed is not shaking. Results. Results. I don't care whether you shake like a leaf. Results, brothers and sisters.
I just want to praise you. I lift my hands to say I love you. You are everything to me, and I exalt your holy name. I exalt your holy name. I exalt your holy.
John said, go and ask Jesus, are you the Messiah? Is it true that the anointing is on you? And Jesus said, all right, watch this. The blind eyes open, the deaf ears hear. And he said, go back and tell John. How do you know a man who is anointed? Results. Results. Don't trivialize results. It's not all about the results. Are you joking? What then is it about? Results. Lives changed. Results. Hallelujah. When there are miracles and signs and wonders and lives transform, you speak to someone and just one prophetic word turns his life around. You've had all kinds of testimonies here. Someone with jammed result, 140 something. After prayer, you come back 260 something. How do you explain that? It's the anointing. A woman barren for 8 years returns with triplets, no CS. How do you explain that? Results. Are we together? Results. A whole family almost ravaged with HIV. That cause, and it's not by sleeping around. And just one prayer and everyone is healed. Not just one person. It's called results. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you the truth. You may be criticized, but you will never be ignored. Once the anointing of the Spirit is upon the life of a man, upon the life of a business, Satan will raise criticisms. Why? So that your word will not be heard, so that you will not be believed, and so that people will not be blessed. But here's what the Bible says: you can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth. The truth was buried only for 3 days. After 3 days, it came back to life. Results. Results. Notable results. Not just results. It says the Spirit of the Lord. Please give us Isaiah 61. The messianic prophecy. It was a prophecy about Jesus Christ. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he says, for he has anointed me to preach glad tidings to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to set the captives free. Are we together? And then he continues and he says to proclaim liberty to the captives, and all of that, to proclaim the year of vengeance of our God, and all of that, to comfort all those who mourn, verse 3. And then he says to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. That's what the anointing does. Beauty for ashes. The oil of joy for the garment of praise. Right? The oil of joy for mourning. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Then it says that they may be called oaks or trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he through them might be glorified. That they may be called oaks of righteousness. Brothers and sisters, when a man comes to a ministry, wretched, terrible, not born again, and something happens to him, it's called the anointing. You get born again, you get filled with the Holy Spirit, your life is transformed, your mindset is changed, you become a leader, you become an ambassador.
The Word of God is the seed containing the very life of God. It is His agent of transformation. As you receive these words in your heart with faith, that life is released into your spirit, and your life receives a supernatural lifting. Join Apostle Joshua Selman as he brings you God's Word with simplicity and power.
Lift your voice and speak and declare that I am an overcomer. By the power of the Holy Ghost, I am an overcomer. Lift your voice and pray. Victory belongs to Him. Victory belongs to Him. And then in Him it belongs to me. Through Christ belongs to me. Through Christ belongs to me. Shabarata kabarato soto baladaba. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. I like you to lift your voice and say, Lord, help me trust you. I am human. Help me trust you. There's something about my humanity that frustrates my trust in you. Help me trust you. Help me trust you. Help me trust you. Shabarada katana. Help me trust you. Are you praying? Likabrasada ritaya. Challenges are not unusual, but defeat is very unusual. Very unusual. Are you praying? Please lift your voice and be serious. Trust. Mike made a statement that touched me so much when he came up. He said, there are limitless possibilities, but they are dependent on your desire. Not just careless desire. Proverbs 18 verse 1, through desire, a man, any man, having separated himself, seeketh and intermeddleth with all wisdom. I like you to pray and say, Lord, I desire an encounter. There is something I need to hear tonight that will take me to the next dimension. There is something I have to hear. There is something I have to hear. There is something I have to hear tonight. Shila parato so zibada kalaparianda kasivata. There is something I have to get tonight. Sing it, that part that says you hold the universe. Can you sing that part? That's what I want you to hear.
You hold the universe. You hold everyone on earth. Yeah, you hold. You hold the universe.
Choose to believe you. We are men and women who have chosen to trust you. We believe you. We believe your ways. We believe your truth. We are not rebels. We will not argue with your truth. Your word is infallible. It's been tested too many times to be doubted. Lord, tonight we align our hearts to your truth, the truth that make us free and the truth that can lift us up. We declare in the name of Jesus that word that upholds all things will uphold our lives. Lord, tonight we submit our hearts to your wisdom. We declare our need for wisdom. We declare our need for wisdom. And Lord, we crave for it. We cry for it. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Before we sit down, it never gets too much to pray. I just like you to pray just one prayer and say, Lord, I crave for your wisdom. I reckon that I need more of your wisdom, and I crave for it. Like a man seeks for silver, like a man seeks for gold, I crave for your wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing, the Bible says. Therefore, get wisdom. It says, with all thy getting, get understanding. Exalt her, and she shall promote thee. She shall bring an ornament of glory, a crown shall she deliver unto thee when thou dost embrace her. Hallelujah. Please be seated. Good evening, everyone. I never stop marveling at the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God can turn any man who believes it and walks in that reality into a sign and a wonder. Hallelujah. And I sincerely believe with all my heart that that is why we are here. I come here because I recognize my need for wisdom. I recognize that it is only in his presence, and only when his word is accurately communicated, the principles of the word are accurately communicated, not the information. The information has no power to produce change. You see, let me tell you something. When people do not have faith, it is not because they do not believe God. There is a level of accuracy with which the word of God was designed to be communicated. And if that word is communicated properly, there is a spiritual logic to it that becomes the basis upon which the faith of the people are grounded. Paul said, when I came to you, I did not come with the excellency of speech, he says, but in the demonstration of power, that your faith will not be grounded upon the wisdom of men, Sophia, wisdom that is a product of education, experience, that is limited, suggestions of men, opinions that were based on a very short view. But the Bible says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled. It never said it's settled in the earth, it's settled in heaven. It takes doing what heaven has done to make the word settle in our lives. In the name of Jesus. So I welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. As always, those following us online, thousands of people, we love you, we honor you. Let your hearts be open, let your spirits be open. For those coming here for the first time, this is Koinonia. And we're on a series, Thrive Part 2, Thrive. This is Part 2. The series is an attempt to concretize upon our hearts some of the keys that are required for transgenerational relevance. Some of the keys that are required for rising above the vicissitudes of life. Like I said last week, it will be irresponsible to pretend that the economic turmoil, the hardship, and all of the things that people are going through, it's not telling on people. You cannot imagine the stories that have emerged as a result of people's frustration. Whenever a people are limited in any way, it will only take time they will react. And oftentimes, they will react based on the informations that they have. So they will use violence, they would do a lot of very stupid things. I've heard of people walking naked for money. I've heard of people giving their children for all kinds of immoral things for money. I've heard of people doing all sorts of things. And the truth about it is that except you are shielded with revelation, you will really feel the gravity of what is happening. Institutions are lamenting, churches are lamenting, social organizations, businesses lamenting, the government itself is lamenting, and that means that we have to source for light and life from another dimension, another reality that is beyond the scope of the human experience. Amen. And I started sharing with us last week how that it is possible to rise above these things. I love the song that the worship team communicated. There is victory. Listen, listen. There is no experience of anyone, regardless of what the peculiar experience is, that is worthy enough to disprove the power, the integrity, the glory, and the efficacy of the person and the word of God. Are we together? If I die today of sickness, my dying of sickness will raise a lot of questions among those who love me, those connected to this vision, and several people across the world. But it does not change the fact that God is mighty and it is within his power to heal. Are we together? If you really want to receive from God, you must desist from isolating your singular experience and using it as a template to judge everything the Bible says about God, because our experiences are limited. The Bible says that we see in part, 1 Corinthians 13, we see in part, therefore we prophesy. Our communications and that which we do is according to our perspectives. This is why I seek him as a matter of life and death. Let it not be that I'm holding on to a perspective that after many years of being convicted by it and leading others to be convicted by it, I discover that I have lived in error and I've communicated the same to people. The Bible says that we be careful so that what we call light be not darkness. After many years of a man's life, you can discover that the very foundation upon which your convictions are built upon is wrong, inaccurate, imbalanced. Are we together? So when we come before his presence, our hearts must be opened. You don't come to God with an opinion, hoping that he agrees with you. When you come to him, your heart is absolutely open. You say, Lord, I am aware of my vulnerability. I'm a product of culture. I'm a product of genetic programming. I'm a product of environmental conditioning. And many of the realities that I've held as true, though popular, though spiritual, may not be consistent with your path. So I come to you with every open-heartedness, trusting that you will build, you will tear down, you will rearrange and bring order to my life. And that's what God is doing in the name of Jesus. Every time you see consistent results in the life of a man, in the life of a people, in the life of a territory, it is because there is something that is done correctly. Whether or not the practitioners are aware of the dynamics of what they are doing. Are we together? Whether or not the individuals can explain in detail what they are doing or not. The moment you see consistent results, regardless of limitations, there are laws, there are principles that are being practiced. Are we together? And I'm going to take it from there. I shared with us a few things, 4 points in all. We took two. I will begin to take from where we left off last week, and then we'll continue. Number one, I told us that the key to rising above the vicissitudes of life, rising above the challenges and the things that hold men crippled spiritually, economically, and so on and so forth, the first key is a genuine encounter with Jesus Christ. The first key to becoming relevant is not being educated. The first key to becoming relevant is not having business acumen. It's not even being a leader. Are we together? It's not any of these things. Success and any kind of impact, a life of notable impact, starts from the health and the quality of a man's spiritual life. Say amen. The measure of your impact through God in the kingdom
is directly associated with the genuineness of your hunger, the sincerity of your love for God. While we're away on a ministration in the course of the week, I met a man of God who was at the meeting, and he just came to see me and talk to me. And God did great things and honored himself in the meeting. And the man sat down and he began to weep like a baby. And he said, "Sir, what is the secret?" I don't know how many times people have asked this. What is the secret? And I kept looking at him. And I said, "Sir, I can bet that you might be disappointed if I tell you. I wish the secret were just fasting and prayer. I wish the secret were just the quality of my word study life. I wish the secret were just that I was anointed." As important as those things are, I told him, if you want me to be sincere with you and you have the heart to receive, the secret to the dimensions that by the grace of God I've been able to access, are we together, is tied primarily to my passion for God and my sincere desire to see him glorified. My passion for God and my sincere desire to see him glorified. You've heard me say it, and God knows my heart. I love God more than ministry. I love God more than money. I love God more than anointing. I don't use him for these things. Never have and never will. I'd rather give up ministry 1,000 times to remain in his presence and to remain in love with him. I even love him more than the quest for his presence. This is where I believe many people miss it. Because primarily our motives are corrupted. God for us means many things. For other people, he's just a solution, like a charm, like a genie that you use and invoke his name, invoke his blood, invoke his fire, invoke whatever to get results. You're not going to really host extraordinary results that way. Are we together? A genuine encounter with Jesus that births the fear of God in you, that births love for God and love for humanity. It's not enough to love God. You must love the people he has sent to you, and you must love the body. I love the body of Christ with all my heart. I am part of it. I'm proud to be part of it. I love the body of Christ. I may not agree with every perspective in the body of Christ. I may not hold as part of my conviction every opinion and perspective, but it's too little a reason to not love the body of Christ. I love the body of Christ, regardless of man of God, regardless of denomination, regardless of exploits or setbacks. I genuinely love the body of Christ. Now let me tell you, when you get to this spiritual state, when you can assume this posture, you are ready to host the grace for transgenerational relevance. Not outside of this condition. The Bible says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, neither has it come into the heart of any man that which God has in store, not for them that pray, not for them that seek him, for them that love him. When a man truly falls in love with God and is addicted with his presence, his life, everything about God becomes an obsession to you. His house, his life, his word, everything. Your whole life is poured as a drink offering. Then you are ready to rise above any challenge. I'm telling you, challenges will come upon you. You will rise and shake them off as if they do not exist. Believe me, I know what I'm saying. Are we together? So we discussed that. And I said how that many believers, they may be born again, but they've not had a genuine encounter with Jesus. An encounter that is greater than any circumstance. You know, when people doubt God and turn and insult God to his face over situations and circumstances, "Lord, I prayed for tea. You didn't give me tea. I prayed for bread. You didn't give me bread. I prayed for CGPA. I prayed for a job. You are not faithful. And you know, God, if you don't do this, I will backslide." It's because you've not had an encounter. The remedy for that kind of talk is just an encounter. It's not counseling. The remedy is an encounter. There is a way that a man encounters God that you owe him your allegiance regardless of what happens around your life. Are we together? It's very important. Whether you bless me or not, I'm in love with you to a point of addiction. Whether ministry rises or not, it has no, it does not contribute in any way to influencing my love and my appetite for you. Please, I pray that as you listen to me, this will become a reality. That this will not just become a talk from a preacher. You see, when you are pretending certain things in the kingdom, it will only take time. Time does not change anything, but time is a revealer of motives. Time will reveal whether you genuinely love God or not. The second thing we said that is the key, and I'll pick up from here now, that's where we left off last week, is the power of mental transformation. The second key that is required to rise above and beyond the challenges in life, listen please, to rise above the limitations that plague mankind, to rise to a life that is of notable transgenerational relevance, a degree of kingdom impact that outlives you if Christ tarries, the power of mental transformation. Listen, I said it never tires me to communicate to God's people the extent to which the quality of their paradigm can determine the course of their future in ministry, in life, in business, in marriage, in any area at all. The quality of your mindset. Are we together? And I told us last week that we are conditioned in two ways, basically. The first condition is a genetic programming. We are programmed genetically by reason of the transfer of traits. I'm being very slow and being very detailed because I want us to get this. The second, which is the most disastrous or most notable of the transformations, is environmental programming. Say environmental programming. We are programmed environmentally, which can be engineered by culture, past experiences, our levels of exposure, the environment that we grew up in. Chances are that if you never saw a successful person growing up, you do not have a reference. You see, belief is based on a reference. Are we together? You cannot believe vaguely. There must be a reference, preferably a physical living reference that becomes a standard and the platform upon which your convictions are built. This is why the disciples were very powerful. Jesus was a reference. And that's why every leader that must teach people, part of the assignment of every leader is not only to communicate his persuasions, but to be a reference of the same. It is easy for people to believe when there is a measure, when a leader is in different ways reference worthy, it becomes easy for individuals to connect. When a man is teaching about the anointing and there is some degree of the demonstration of the power and the grace of God upon his life, it becomes easy for the listeners to be persuaded by that dimension. Are we together? It is very difficult. Listen, it is very difficult to persuade people over a reality that your life cannot be a reference of. No matter how little the reference is, that it is worthy of conviction. The same thing I am teaching now, I am going to be teaching it 10, 15 years to come. But it will be more impactful than it is now, because by that time, my life will be a higher reference than it is now. The same way some of the things I'm sharing now were the things that I shared a number of years past, but their impact were not as impactful as it is now. Of course, I've grown in the anointing, but also there have been maybe a few evidences here and there that can back up and support that communication. Communicating a dimension of spiritual reality or a dimension of any reality that does not have your life as a commendable reference is very frustrating. This already is a lesson for someone, that if you want to change your world, the first key is to change yourself. That you become a template enough. People are not that hardened. People are only obsessed with results. It is God that sees the heart. Men look at the outward appearance. They want to see that if you are teaching on divine health, there is a measure of that reality at work in you. If you are teaching on kingdom wealth and prosperity, there is a measure of that reality. If you are teaching on leadership or excellence or dimensions of kingdom reality, there is a level of persuasion that stems from your own experience. Are we blessed tonight? The power of mental transformation. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 9, it says, receiving the end of your faith. We discussed that last week. It said, even the salvation of your soul. The salvation of your soul. Bringing your soul through the renewal of your mind to a point where it can host the realities that are resident within your spirit. I began to discuss with us, and we've done this over different series as we've discussed through the years, the power of paradigms. Look at me. Listen, let me tell you something. As great as a man is, he can limit God. Remember our scripture that has become an anthem in this place, Psalm 78 verse 41. They limited the Holy One. They limited the Holy One. They limited the Holy One. They said, can God make a table in the wilderness? They limited the Holy One. It was not their fault, it was their conditioning. After 430 years of servitude with no hope of deliverance, it was understandable that such a people, as a corporate entity, can doubt God. Something about our culture, as good as it is, something about our cultural experiences have informed us, has created an understanding in our minds. I was talking to a dear friend today who came over to see me, and we were discussing certain things. He was along the side of the line of marriage and all of that, and I was sharing with him, generally speaking, we got into different discussions, and I was telling him that if I were to counsel an intending couple, I'm not going to waste time asking a lot of useless and vague questions. The first thing I want to examine is their passion for God. And then the next thing, I want to examine the extent of their compatibility in terms of their understanding. What is your viewpoint about God? What is your viewpoint about money? What is your viewpoint about your assignment and purpose? What is your viewpoint about your personal life? What is your viewpoint about external influences in your life and home? This does not just apply to the line of marriage, it applies to everything. There is something culture taught us about God. There is something our well-meaning pastors and preachers told us about God. Their experiences were their sermons. They preached it with confidence. We embraced it with sincerity. And we are victims of their limitations. Are we together? There's something that our past experiences have done. I always give an example. If it took someone 10 years to get admission, and you teach on favor, it will take an extra anointing for that person to understand that message. Are we together? Because there is no template that represents favor in his life. Most of our families live from hand to mouth. So every time we talk about prosperity, our minds go straight to the people they insulted and the way they insulted them. We have associated prosperity with negativism, with fraud, with unseriousness, with fetish, demonic activities, especially when young people are prosperous. And let me tell you something. After listening to a very powerful message, after listening to a powerful series, Financial Dominion, The Wealthy Place, The Economic System of the Kingdom, you will think that your paradigm will change at once. No, it took a long time for it to be built. It will take a repetition of new ideas are the keys to changing our paradigms. You have to bring forth those new ideas again and again. That's why the Bible says faith cometh by hearing, and hearing, the next word hearing there is understanding. Hearing and understanding what you hear by the word of God. Hallelujah. The purpose of prophecy is for edification, for exhortation, and for comfort. Prophecy does not condemn. Prophecy does not destroy. Even when God spoke to the prophets in the Old Testament, he would always tell them what to do. Nineveh, I'm about to destroy you people.
And this is what will happen. However, they declared a fast and the mercy of God came in. Remember, the Bible says the Lord is full of grace. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, right? Full of love. I mean, how did he put it now? Rich in love. The Lord is merciful and compassionate. He's rich in love. His mercies are new every morning. Those of us here who are seeing visions, having dreams, document these things and seek guidance first, especially when you are beginning to walk in the gifts of the Spirit. Be careful. Don't authoritatively go and meet people. They have a lot of respect for you and they will listen to everything. I am careful when I speak to people, because even when I joke, they don't take it lightly. I can be joking with somebody and say, ah, God bless you, and the person wants to kneel down. And I'm saying, I'm a human being. This is not anointing. I'm joking. Just joking with you. And you see, the thing about the anointing is every time there is a demand, whether you are joking or not, that person can now fall down, now embarrass me there and make it look as if, you know, I hardly have people to play with. It's a very, this anointing sometimes is a very, your life can be very, very lonely. Someone sees you are trying to smile and the person is already believing that maybe it's a word from God. I am a human being. Jesus ate corn in the farm on Sunday. Remember? Jesus was with a woman and they were talking. I mean, please. And I think some of us men of God that make this happen. You know, the way we spiritualize it and make it look as if you are in the spirit every time. It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. Bible says walking in the spirit, yes, but it's not in the character of, you can't smile, you can't do anything, you feel bad. If I am angry and I slap David Dam's head, I should just say sorry. I shouldn't make it look as if it's the Holy Spirit that made me do it. No, this is, I'm a human being. I was carried away, I got emotional and touched his head. I'm a human being. Jesus was angry. Did he say it was the Holy Spirit who made him angry? No. Prophecy, but we need it. Now, the last thing I'll say about prophecy before we move on is the fact that you must never resent it. The resentment we have for prophecy, we have mixed the baby and the bad water and thrown it away. There are two dimensions of prophecy. There is the revelatory dimension of prophecy. There is the creative dimension of prophecy. The revelatory dimension has to do with insight and informations about people, situations, nations like Jeremiah. The creative dimension of prophecy is when you have the word of God alongside the grace for performance. When the prophet said by this time tomorrow, he was not revealing, he was creating. Are we together now? We must desire it. The church that rejects the prophetic is going to be in trouble. Prophecy is very important. A man's life can change overnight because of prophecy. There are many of us, if only we embrace the ministry of prophecy, we would have left this realm. Left the current dimensions that we are in. But we've been grounded because of a cynicism. The moment you see someone saying the Lord is, please, all you this stupid, especially if he's a young one. That's why they see everybody, they mix, join all of us together and just throw all of us and make it look as if we're all demons. No, no. Hallelujah. Nothing happens in the earth realm until prophecy announces it. Nothing happens in the earth realm until prophecy announces it. Nothing happens in the earth realm until prophecy announces it. Prophecy is not just a revelation, it's an authorization for spiritual things to find expression. All through scripture, you see angels bringing messages and heralding them before those occurrences begin to happen. Let's go to the next gift, faith. There is the law of faith, an operation of faith. There is the spirit of faith. There is the gift of faith. What is the gift of faith? An unusual ability to believe God.
an unusual ability to believe God that is higher and greater than your current world level, higher and greater than your level of spiritual exposure. There are times, because you see, generally speaking, your faith level is proportionate to the level of the word of God that is in you. Your level of understanding of scripture and the ways of God is commensurate to your faith. There are certain challenging situations in your life, in leadership. There are times that you need to bring certain realities from the realm of the spirit that is higher and bigger than your personal walk with God. At that point, you don't just need the law of faith. You need the gift of faith. The gift of faith is always short-lived, because under that influence of the gift of faith, anything uttered will come to pass. It is the reason why God does not leave people to walk with it for a long time, because our unrenewedness will destroy people's lives. The gift of faith is the operation of the faith of God, not faith in God. The very faith of God working in a human vessel. The faith that created the heavens and the earth, not the word of God, the very faith of God, an impartation of that faith to help you command realities that otherwise will not come. That's why the gift of faith works peri passu with the working of miracles. There are certain situations that are challenging, higher than you do not even understand the dynamics of that result as it is, but the gift of faith comes upon you. The character of the gift of faith is unusual courage and audacity. Unusual courage. It has happened to many of us in the place of prayer. Fear takes you to the place of prayer, and you are praying and prophesying, praying, and all of a sudden an ability comes upon you, and you begin to speak and say audacious things, not even caring who is listening. Later, when you hear what you say, even you are embarrassed by it. It's a sign that you are not the one who said it. I decree and declare in the name of Jesus Christ, tomorrow by 9 o'clock a helper is appearing, and your neighbor is watching you. Say, hey, I just gave this guy one spaghetti, and that's not you. Because let me tell you how you know that's not you. By 12:30 you will sit down and say, hey, why did I now embarrass myself? You call it an embarrassment because your original faith level has returned now. And you are seeing that that faith level cannot accommodate that level of miracle. But God had to move through you. And truly you will see that a miracle will happen. That's why you give him glory when it happens. When they say man of God, you quickly turn and say, God is you. One of the hallmark of the apostolic ministry is the gift of faith. The gift of faith. Daring things by the gift. That's why those who are called in the apostolic ministry, if they don't allow the Holy Spirit work on them, usually they are very, very arrogant, very outspoken, sometimes very sarcastic. It's a side effect that comes with the office. Your intimacy with the Holy Spirit is a secret to correcting it. So that I work in an apostolic office and I am arrogant and sarcastic and outspoken and some of these wrong things, I may say it is how it is. No, your walk with the Holy Spirit was designed to correct it. It's like you are cooking in the kitchen. The moment you put, I don't have any business with the kitchen, but I'm just saying what I remember. I know that when you put palm oil in a hot pot, what happens? There's a side effect. The whole kitchen and maybe the neighboring environment, it can be choking. Does that mean you should stop the cooking? People are hungry, they are waiting for the meal. But then you have to create a way of managing it. So most times before women will start, they will do it outside or they will open the window in advance. That's how you work. You must create a system with God to cover for the side effect that operation comes. You don't choke people and say you are boiling palm oil. No. If I keep insulting Pastor Alpha, stupid, you are crazy. You are a stupid person. And then I say it is the anointing. No, it is not the anointing. It is the effect of the anointing. Yes, but then the unrenewed part of me mixing with the anointing is what produces that outcome. It can be corrected. Hallelujah. That's why when Paul finished giving us an exegesis of all the gifts of the Spirit, he said, I show you a more excellent way. A more excellent way of administering the gifts. That if they do not work by love, you are not operating the more excellent way. Are we together? Every one of us here will require this gift if you must get results in your life. A day will come when your faith level cannot take the kind of miracles you need. The urgency around it will require the gift of faith. There are times you see during the miracle service, I'm just walking and looking at people, and I know that this situation is very challenging. Sometimes the people are waiting for me to come, please help that person under the anointing. And then the person can just whisper, sorry sir, I have HIV, and this HIV self is not just me, my wife and my child. You don't have to tell everybody. Now you are standing there, or someone is saying he has tuberculosis and is coughing in your coughing before your face, and you are inhaling the thing. If this thing is not working in you, you do this for 5 years, the probability of catching tuberculosis is 100%. 100%. That's why we tell people to walk with God before they begin to move in certain levels of ministry. It's not pride. If I've been faking this thing by now, you will see it. It will destroy you one day, because you are laying hands on people. It's not, this laying on of hands is not something you do just because you are anointed. That's why sometimes you see me pray for these people before we allow them to go. It's not some man of God thing. You are contending spirits. You can carry problems you have no business carrying. Leave someone land upon your life. You finish that service, you go back. Have you not seen people who minister to the sick, and what was on them, the person went back to sleep, one leg could not lift one leg again. That boomerang effect. I believe in the gift of faith. Let me submit to you that where God has brought us by his grace in this ministry is an operation of the gift of faith. There was a year, let me tell you a little story. There was a year when, early that year, before Koinonia would start, God gave an instruction that we should carry every one naira in this ministry and sow it as a seed. 1 week to Koinonia resuming. I can't remember which of the years was that. Everything. I said, God, everything. Now, let me tell you, you better make sure that gift is working in your life, because that's suicidal. Not that you should carry a sizable seed and go and give. Empty everything. Close everything. And I did it foolishly and stupidly. I submit to you, in less than 7 days, more than 10 times that amount return. That's faith. You need it. Some of us right now, you wrote your exams. Humanly speaking, you are not going to graduate. One, you wrote nonsense. Two, you didn't finish. You need the gift of faith. You need the gift of faith. Are we together?
Yes.
There are wicked supervisors ready to make sure they frustrate you. How about getting a job? You keep carrying your certificate to everybody and say, sorry, we don't need what you studied. And at a point you feel bad and say, is it my fault that I studied this? One day while you are praying, the gift of faith comes on you and you make declarations by the Spirit. All of a sudden, someone calls you. You need it. It is given to help believers. Our families, many of us, our families are in a mess. We need the operation of this gift to correct things. You see that lady that testified? That was what was working in her. The dear lady that said she went home. Gather your relatives. What if it doesn't work? Do you know what? You can be stupid by yourself, but to gather relatives who are not born again and then it doesn't work. Abba. The gift of faith. When you have plan B, it is your faith. When there is no plan B, it is the gift of, if I perish, that's what was on Esther. When she was on her way going to meet Ahasuerus, the destiny of the nation of Israel was at stake, and she entered, if I perish. Ask her to say it after that time, she won't be able to say it again. Hallelujah. That was the grace that was at work in Moses. When Moses went before God, he said, "Why are you crying to me?" Moses said, "What is all this? 2 million people are shouting. These guys are going to kill me. You don't know how hardened they are." And God says, "Go and part the rivers." Theologically, historically speaking, historians tell us that it's not like the river parted and they told people, "Now walk." Do you know the miracles that happened there? Even if the river parted, there's going to be space on the ground. Are you going to jump down? Won't you die? So the ground had to lift and come up to where they were for them to be able to walk through it. And Moses took his rod, stood before 2 point something million people and said, "People, the Egyptians you see today, that's the spirit of faith. I speak to someone, or the Egyptians you see today, in the name of Jesus Christ, after this meeting, you will see them no more forever. I say it again, the Egyptians you see today, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose faith is at work here, you will see them no more after today." Please sit down. The gift of faith. A man of God, true story, many of you will know him, Pastor Korede Komaya. I think it was Bishop Aremu's wife. Bishop Aremu's wife, she, you know, they have twins, and she was sitting with the man's wife and then looked at him and said, "Ah, Yusef, how many children do you have?" And she, I think she had just maybe one or two then, and she looked at her and carried her this thing ladies tie, their head tie, and threw it on her and said, "Take twins, Joe." That was it. The woman got pregnant, twins, gave birth. That's not guess. That's not guess. When you see it happen, sometimes I see it happen, I'm surprised. Somebody can come and while he's talking and giving every long explanation, "Apostle, this is happening." It's like prophecy. I don't even know when it comes out of my mouth. I just say, "It is done. Go." And you see the person living disappointed. "You didn't even wait for me to finish. I struggled. I joined the line. I humbled myself. What is all this? Let me express." And then the person goes back and things change. The gift of faith is powerful. Are we blessed? The gift of healing, Jesus. I wish I had time to dwell on this. Maybe we'll take another series next year. Notice that the Bible does not say the gift of healing. He said the gift, G-I-F-T-S, the gifts of healing. What is it? The ability to bring physical and emotional healing to people. The ability to supernaturally bring physical and emotional healing. You know, years ago, I really used to laugh at white people. When I see all of them, every little thing they cry. Every little thing they cry. "How did you get here?" And she's trying to explain just that there was a delay with taxi. And then she starts crying. They give her a handkerchief. What sort of human beings are these? I mean, just anything makes them cry. Men, women. But as I grew in leadership, I found out that emotional brokenness is worse than physical sickness. The Bible says a broken spirit dryeth the bones. There is a way a man can be emotionally devastated and die, not by any physical sickness. Are we together? Emotional wounds are created because of words and circumstances. They are more hurtful. If I slap you and the sign of my hand is on your face, it won't reach 2 days, that thing will disappear, correct? But if I speak something negative about your life, you can hold that word for 10 years and it will not leave you. Is that true? The same thing. How many of you have seen people with diabetes and you see an injury that will not heal? It looks like it will not, and that's exactly what happens to the spirits of people. Hence the ministry of people like Joyce Meyer and all of this. You can look at them and feel, no falling down, no shouting. I tell you the truth, they are doing a major healing ministry. 95% of Africans before age 15 have been raped by wicked words, from the ones who called you stupid to the one who called you idiot, to your teacher who said you will have a big head, you are dull, to the mistakes you made. to the fact that you were the oldest person in your class, Baba class 4. You don't know those things were affecting you. A broken spirit. You get to school and everybody's harassing you. People look at you and say, I hope you know you're a very ugly lady. I'm sorry, I have to just tell you my mind. And the person thinks he's being bold. That accumulation, demon spirits find a safe haven in that mindset, and it destroys you. And you find out anything God tells you, you just look at him and say, God, use somebody. Those kinds of words are reflections of emotions that have been broken. That's why worship like this creates that kind of healing. You can raise a song, and while everybody is laughing, only one person is crying. That person is getting healed. At the end of it, it's like, you know how you bath? Someone just feels light, feels I have been healed from this. I have counseled people, and I am amazed at the things people go through, and yet they still smile and walk. There are people, if they give you half of the emotional load on their head, it will kill you instantly. Yet they are carrying it and saying, hallelujah, praise the Lord. The Bible says, rejoice not over me, my enemies. There are many of our parents, when they lost their last job, they never got another one again. Do you know why? Because the way they disgraced them and drove them out of that company, it was so embarrassing. And they said, I can't do this to myself again. Sir, but you're a PhD holder. No, I'd rather remain poor. After 10 years, how about those who, but please don't feel bad, those who marriage did not work for? Have you seen people like that? And after 20 years, you tell them it's okay now. I think you can get back. I know, okay, maybe your wife died or something happened, and they tell you, look, the memory is still as fresh as yesterday. Have you seen people say, I will never forgive you till Jesus comes? That's what emotional devastation can do. There are people here, as I'm talking, God is healing you from this. Because let me tell you, it's a luggage. Oh, I was raped when I was 2 years. I was raped when I was 5 years. The house boy that worked for us raped me. Some of us were raped by our own parents, sadly. Are we together? And you grow and those things are still in your mind. I can never make it. You wrote WAEC 10 times, JAM 11 times. There is no understanding of favor. So every time we say God is favoring people, you just look and say, is it me you are talking to? Healing. If you are not healed and God ever gives you an opportunity to be a leader, you will judge everything from the template of your emotional wounds. If someone laughs at you, you say, why are you laughing at me? Because you remember that that's how they laughed at you to mock you. The person was laughing, rejoicing with you, but your cynicism, you see that? Your wife just looks and says, ah, my husband. I say, please, I don't like disrespect. I say, my husband again. I've told you, this is how my mother did it. Must everybody know I'm the last one? It's not about that situation. There is something that has created a wound in you. Are we together? There are some of you, they use all kinds of words. You had nicknames, ugly nicknames and cliches. Some of you used to urinate in secondary school or primary school, although you were, it was a situation that required prayer, and the adults there did not have spiritual intelligence to help. And this, I remember that time, they would gather the person who is easy himself and sing songs and dance around, and the person who stand like this with your bed sheet, that you who urinated, what a way of destroying people. Don't ever do that to anybody. How about brothers that blast ladies? You are not fine, you are not this. And they say, I gave it to her. Well, how about the ladies that blast a guy? She blasted him in 99. Till now, he has not approached any lady. Every time he wants to go, that wound. God is bringing deliverance in the name of Jesus Christ. But there is a physical healing. There is the physical healing. The healing ministry is needed more than ever before. I was listening to Benny Hinn not too long before I came, and you know, I hear him read these healing scriptures and I am touched. We need to bring the healing power of God back to the church. I tell you this, there's too much, there is very little of genuine healing. Not everybody is in a wheelchair, but let me tell you, there are people who need physical healing. Physical healing. How God, Acts chapter 10 and verse 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, and the Bible says he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed. Healing oppressed. Healing oppressed. Every sickness is an oppression. From headache to your hair falling to all of this. I remember, I think it was in Mina or so, when I saw a very touching miracle. A gentleman that has never smelled anything in his life, doesn't know how you put perfume, he just looks at you. You know what a bad way to live. What of those who don't hear well? What of those who don't see well? All kinds of sicknesses. The first time I would pray for a lady years ago, and the lady told me she had no womb. I don't mean something was wrong, no womb. Anybody that doesn't believe in miracles, don't argue with the person. The day the doctor cannot help you, I promise you, you must believe. I believe in the healing power of Jesus. Aura Roberts will say this every day of his life. I am called to bring the healing power of Jesus to the nations. He believed it. Are we together? There are people here seated looking at me who have all kinds of things, incurable diseases. Every time a medical predicament defies drugs and medical attention, then there is a spirit behind it. Are we together now? Yes. And let me say something about the gift of healing. Most people have been indoctrinated in the church to hate doctors and hate medicine. I will never teach that. You will never hear me teach that. I believe in divine health. I believe in all of this, but day and night, we're taking people to the hospital to take care of them. We have lots of doctors here. A few of them will be doctors by next week or week after next, and all of that. We have a lot of our doctors. Yes. You actually can clap. I mean, it's not all of them smiling already. They will come and dance before God here to the shame of the devil. So please don't get into this resentment. I can't take drugs. You are about dying. Just Panadol will solve that problem. Now, of course, there are times that you stretch your faith. If you stretch it and it doesn't seem to work, take the Panadol, cure yourself, and keep studying the word. There is a realm of divine health. I believe that. Are we together? But we must never stigmatize people. So you see people secretly buying drugs. They buy malaria drugs. They run and take injection for 5 days and come and hold the mic and say, in the last 10 years, I've not even taken paracetamol. Let's be honest. Let's fear God. Jesus is called the great physician. Physician. Say, is there no balm in Gilead? Praise God. I believe in medicine. And when you pray for people, especially over a sensitive case, don't stop them from taking their normal medication. When they become healed, medicine will confirm it. Are we together now? Especially for maybe HIV patients or people with some terminal diseases. There are many pastors who have killed innocent people. They prayed for the HIV patient, for instance, and said, do you believe? Yes. Stop taking your antiretroviral drugs. And the person was very fine. But now, after 4 or 5 months, you find out that the person started emaciating and the person died. When you pray for someone and it does not work, please take the person to the hospital. If you yourself are sick and you've prayed and prayed and nothing works, you can still be declaring the word of God. Medicine is still a miracle. You don't talk to the drug, you swallow it. The drug finds where your problem is. The whole pharmacology behind that drug is a miracle. So don't act as if you didn't tell the drug, come to my ears. You just swallowed it. It's a miracle. By God's grace, we will never discourage people. We have a first aid box as a ministry. If someone collapses now under the anointing and all of that, if he needs medical attention, there are doctors here who will attend to him. Let's be responsible. These are the things that try to make those who walk in power look like fools. Because we keep killing people every day, destroying people and not stopping, you know, stopping people from medical attention. I don't do that. Tonight, I believe that God is going to bring his healing power again to someone. I believe in the ministry of healing. I have been a victim of sickness, so I know the relevance of healing. I've shared with you my testimony when I had a fungal infection that ate my head. Pastor, completely ate everything here. You won't see one, it was just wounds everywhere. I know the rejection that sickness brings. I buy puff puff for people, they won't collect it because my hand touched it. Even if I washed it in their presence, can stigmatize you. How about the woman with the issue of blood? There are people living examples like that. I remember praying for a lady who would bleed non-stop for sometimes like 3 or 4 months. This lady can stand and be dizzy and just collapse, like pass out. We need to bring the healing power of God to people. We need to let them see the power of God in their lives. The devil is afflicting people with all kinds of sicknesses. And tonight, in the name of Jesus, is someone's night. The last gift of the Spirit, and then we'll pray. The working of miracles. What is the working of miracles? The ability to bring about supernatural results, supernatural occurrences that are above the laws of nature, the ability to produce supernatural results above and beyond the laws of nature. The working of miracle defies process. There is no process with the working of miracles. Now, life is a process, but the working of miracles, what happened in Samaria was a working of miracles. By this time tomorrow, the economy of a nation will be completely changed. There are many of us who need miracles. A healing is a miracle when it is instant. When a healing is instant, it's called a healing miracle. Miracles are not just limited to human bodies, finances. Jesus performed that operation. He said, go and catch a fish, open the mouth, pick money out. That's the working of miracles. Are we together now?
Yes.
I believe in the working of miracles. I've seen it happen in my life. I've seen it happen in the ministry. The multiplication of 5 loaves and 2 fish, that was not just divine supply, that was the working of miracles. What of the fish that they caught? Master, we have toiled all night, nevertheless at thy word. Then he said, cast your net to the right side. And they caught so much fish, they had to beckon on their partners. What of Ezekiel 37? Restoration is a miracle. Bones that have gone. And then the Bible says something that always intrigues me when I read it. It says bone was joined to its bone, meaning no bone made a mistake. Every bone located the right one. Miracles. Someone is here and is in need of a miracle. You are not sick in your body, but there is a situation in your life that needs the intervention of God's hand. If you go through the normal course of the law of process, you may never be able to catch up. Restoration is one of those aspects in a man's life that requires the gift of the working of miracles. And I will restore to you the years. Can years be restored? I thought it's just material things that can be restored, but God says, no, not with me. When I can work a miracle. The Bible talks about Zion giving birth in one day. That, have you ever heard this? He said, as soon as Zion travails, she shall put forth her son. Let me tell you, I want you to get ready for strange occurrences in your life. Things that will happen, you will know that this is only God. They will say, but I know it took 10 years to build the house. And you say, my brother, I was sitting down like this and a key came to me. Miracles. The Bible never said Mary was pregnant for 9 months. No, sir. The angel never told Mary according to the time of life. It was never said that pregnancy was 9 months. Miracles. The nation of Israel, 430 years captivity in one night. He said they chased them. They didn't even allow their bread to rise. They said, please get out of this place. Are we together? The Lord has declared that this is a year of triumph. Let me tell you this. I truly believe in restoration and I believe in speed. Pastor Femi, come. Pastor Alpha, come. Let me show you something very quickly and then we'll pray. Please stand here, gentlemen. Just stand close to me. Watch this. If Pastor Femi and Pastor Alpha are making progress in life, this is them walking. Is that true? And then something keeps Pastor Alpha down. Are you seeing Pastor Femi is moving forward now? Now, Pastor Alpha, start walking slowly. This is progress, not restoration. Restoration means he must be here because this was his original place. Now, let me tell you what this miracle does. It picks you and puts you so that if they check your life, they cannot see where the delay was. So when God says, I will restore, he didn't say, I will release the force so that you make progress. No, sir. There are many of us at your age, there are things that should have happened. What you need is not progress. You need restoration. Restoration. This gift of the Spirit is a strange operation of the Spirit where people's lives can change overnight. Overnight. God can give speed, though. God can bring his word to pass in people's lives. He said, rejoice not over me, my enemies. Oh, the fact that I lost my job and you are seeing me and my wife, we are just moving around and I'm not eating anything, you are laughing. But the day this God arises in 24 hours, I've seen God do things in my life that has brought tears in my eyes. I said, God, so this is what you can do. Some of you have never been surprised by God. There is a way God will do something. Your first cry is not the miracle, it's how it happened. God, I've always heard that you can move like this, but this one that you have done it to me. No, Lord, I fear you. He said he does these things that men will fear him. When he does it, he signs his signature on your life. I am God. Jabez was a man who was born in sorrow. The mother cursed him because of the pain he caused her. And Jabez said, oh, that thou wouldest enlarge me. God, even if you release me to start moving forward, now, when will I make it? Let me tell you, we need speed in Nigeria. Everything is against a young man's establishment. Everything. If you are in ministry, you need this gift in your life, otherwise you will be in trouble. Nobody will give you chair, nobody will give you canopy, nobody will give you money. If you don't know how to command miracles, please help that person under the anointing there by the power of God. There are situations tonight that need to hear the word of the Lord. God is a miracle worker. God is a glorious God. God is, I know you are some miracle worker in my life, Lord. God is a glorious. Just sing it one more time to build faith in your heart. My God is. He's a miracle walker, miracle walker.
God is
your glorious
God.
One more time, say God is. He's a miracle,
a miracle.
glorious
God. There is hope for a tree, even if it be cut. There is hope. There is hope. Apostle, at my age, I've not even gotten admission. My brother, there is hope. This God, in God's economy, 1 + 1 is not 2. 1 + 1 is any answer he gives. Any answer. 1 + 1 can be a car. What is the relationship between alphabets and car? The word of God. 1 + 1 can be breakthrough. God can carry a man's lifetime achievement and give you in 1 month. Listen, this is not some get rich quick things. I don't encourage people to be irresponsible, but I'll be a stupid person to tell you I don't believe God can change people's lives overnight. Look at this ministry. Look at my life. Whoever told you God cannot arise for people? Listen, if you don't believe what I'm teaching you, you will struggle in your life as if God is not. The part of scripture you believe is the part that works for you. Are we together? Listen, if you are married and 3 years you've not had a child, or 4 years you have not had a child, if you have one child, that's a testimony, but that's not yet your portion. If you have twins, you have covered ground. That's restoration. Are you hear what I'm saying? If you graduated 2000 and let's say 6, and by 2015 you cannot even rent a house, if they give you a job with 100,000, that's not yet your portion. That's not your portion. Come on now, how can that be your portion? When somebody gets up and say, I'm going abroad, my house, my car, and the payment of the school fees I've left, the Lord say I should give you. That's your portion now. God is called the God of portions. I know this about him. Righteousness and justice. Justice. She came to him and said, avenge me my enemies. The man neither feared God nor men, but because she impersonated him. Listen, let me tell you, when I begin to pray and make demands over things in my life, I don't spare. I say, God, I'm not where I should be. Oh, I'm not where I should be. No, I'm moving forward. Thank you. But you said I will restore. You didn't say I will make progress. Are we together? Yes. That's how to pray. Lord, as a lady, I plan marrying 22. I'm 32. I can't just marry and continue. You are going to find a way of carrying me. Shabakatos lekota sabriata katoshiata. Hallelujah. Lord, I would have gotten a job in 2010. The man said I should sleep with him and get the job, but because of you I refuse. Now it's 2017. I'm 7 years. My payroll is 7 years. Where is the window of heaven? I place that demand. And brothers and sisters, you will see God do things that they will think you held a charm. A God that we serve, the working of miracles. God is truly a miracle worker. I've seen him change people's lives. I've seen him step into families. This year, God has done things in my life that brought tears in my eyes. I said, God, what is this? Can you allow God use your life to reveal his name? The names of God are a revelation of his possibilities. There are names you are just calling, but you have never really seen it. Listen, early this year I taught on the gifts of men. That thing was not a message. It's a fearful dimension of God that God brought me into, where men stand up to solve your problems as if you charm them. There is a grace that makes that happen. You will never listen. There are some miracles that if they have not happened in your life, you will never have time to serve God. Let's tell ourselves the truth. Some of you have served God 10 years.
you are still begging for bread. Allow God to step in and do something for you. You don't need, you, what you need is more than a job. You need God to sign his name in your life. How much is a job? How much is 100,000? You now have 5 children. Be honest. Will 100,000 bless them when one child's monthly school fees is more than 100,000? You need the gift of the working of miracles. The wine finished in a feast. The gift of miracles is a cure for embarrassment. Cure for embarrassment. The wine finished. And they went to him. He said, fill 6 pots. Alas, master, it was borrowed. He needed the gift of miracles. Every time your life is in a point of embarrassment, that's the gift you need. That's the gift you need. It's the gift you need. I don't know how to make you believe this thing. We are going to pray. Brothers and sisters, before I begin to minister to us, please, I beg you, listen. I want you to be angry at your current level and say, Lord, this is not what I agreed, me and you. This in the secret place. I am not ungrateful, but this is not our agreement. By our agreement, the level of grace I should be walking in now. Your gift, this is not the agreement. Lift your voice and pray. Shabakata paratosia. Bring forth your strong reasons. The gift of the Spirit are the platforms to experience His possibilities. You reign, you reign. Hallowed Him, you reign. Hallowed, you reign, you reign, you reign. Hallowed, you reign, you reign, you reign. Hallowed in you reign, you reign. Hallelujah. I have to stop here so that we can pray. I'm supposed to teach you how to receive the gift, but just leave it. We'll take it another time. We have to pray. This thing I've said, I'm angry in my spirit. We have to pray. There are doors that we must force to open now. There are doors that we must force to open. Let me tell you, listen. If you keep following your life casually, you will never get some breakthroughs. He said, right from the days of John the Baptist and until now, the kingdom of God suffered violence, and the violence will take it by force. Lift your voice and open your mouth. Announce things that must happen this night. Lord, you gave gifts to men. Hey, your magic.
majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty, yeah.
We declare your majesty.
It's your majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty.
Your majesty.
Lekatakatakatakata praskata barakoto shopeketia.
Your majesty.
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 He said, I will walk a walk in your days that if you were told, you will not believe it. I will walk a walk. There is something I want to do in your life. There is something I want to do in your life, in your family. I'd like you to pray in 1 minute. Lord, I believe you all. I believe you. I believe you. Don't let the devil tell you you're wasting your time. Blessed is she that believes. Blessed is she that believes. Visit my finances, O God of heaven. Visit my family. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen. I want us to pray. No matter what has left your life, call it back. Call it back. Lift your voice and pray. Whether it's money that left your life, call it back. Joy, call it back. Even God, who quickeneth the dead, and call it those things, call it those things, call it those things, call it back. Sakata parato shekete. Those outside, make sure you are praying. Those following online, pray. Call it back. By the spirit of faith, by the gift of faith, we call back opportunities. We call back graces. We call back mantles. We call back dimensions.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to pray just before I pray for us. I'm releasing my faith with you. I don't know what God told you should have happened and you have not seen it. I'd like you to insist now and say, God, I've not forgotten. I bring you to remembrance. Early this year, you told me, Lord, you told me I will be laughing by October. I'm not yet laughing. I place a demand. I put pressure on your integrity. Lift your voice. Lift your voice. Place a demand. You said it. You can do it. You said it. You will make it happen. It is within your power. Shabakata praskana mato sembregelegele mo. Ketekete rekete koto shoto preketa leketa paskata barakoto shobre. Hallelujah. 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 Listen. Listen. My Bible says, withhold not good to him that it is due when it is within your power to give. The Bible said it. Don't withhold good. He said, do not say unto him, come today, come tomorrow, where you can do it now. Say, Lord, now faith, now faith. I place a demand. Why wait tomorrow when it can happen now? It is within your power. It is within your power. Change my life now. I place a demand. Cry out for your finances. Cry out for your life. Abarato soto kabaradash. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
I want you to believe God is giving people things as I'm talking. Listen, you won't cry forever. There is a God that is alive. I want you to believe this. I'm saying it, you won't cry forever. I come with an anointing in this place. I come with the anointing that follows this office. You won't cry forever. There is a God that is alive. 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 Hallelujah. The Lord is showing me a family. Before the end of August, four people getting a job. The end of October, four. One, two, three, four. I'm declaring it. I'm declaring it. It will happen to a family. Four people within 2 weeks. A supernatural door. That embargo of witchcraft is broken now. That embargo of witchcraft is broken now. I release the grace that makes this happen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The Lord is showing me someone. We may not have time to call, but you were saving up money to buy something. I don't know if it's a car or land. And God gave you an instruction to sow the money. You sowed the money and shared with somebody, and the person insulted you and called you stupid. And the Lord is saying, I'm seeing a date in the air, November 21. The Lord is saying, between now and that time, as surely as the Lord lives, he's giving you a strange miracle. A strange miracle, November 21. A strange miracle in the name of Jesus Christ. I don't know what has refused to produce in your life. There are some of us, you are laboring, but the truth is nothing is working. There is a spirit of hardship. I told you, hardship is not poverty. Poverty is part of hardship. It's a subset of hardship. When that spirit comes, even if they make you a director, 1 million will not bless you. It's the spirit of hardship. You cannot exactly tell what you are doing with the money. You just know that every time there is a need you don't have, it's a spirit. What you need is not promotion. What you need is the blessing of the Lord to take away that thing. I'm speaking over someone's life. I don't know whose life has been like that, but in the name of Jesus Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit, I decree and declare that embargo of hardship over your life leaves you now. It leaves you now. Now I'm stretching my hands, I'm praying for people. This speed, I want it to come on your life. There is a grace for speed. Look, I'm seeing smoke just rising from the altar right down in the name of Jesus. I stretch my hands and I declare speed, speed, step into dimensions of accomplishment. Speed, overflow one, overflow two, overflow three. Those outside, speed. The main goal here, speed. I command it now. Any area in your life where you have not been moving forward, speed in the name of Jesus. I command speed. I command speed. I command speed. Receive it. I command speed. I don't care the way things have been. I'm speaking in speed to your business. Speed, speed is an anointing. Let it come on you now. Supernatural speed to your life. Speed. In the name of Jesus, I release speed. I release speed. I release speed. I release speed. Hear me. The Bible says, ye have compassed this mountain long enough. There are people where you are, let me tell you, there are spirits keeping you there. Where you are is a mockery to yourself and to your God. In the name of Jesus, this fire that I see in the spirit, let it land on whoever must move forward now. Let it land on whoever must move forward now. I prophesy it in the name of Jesus. The Lord God whom I serve and whose I am, I command speed. I move your life to another dimension. To draw from you again, again. We've come to draw from you again. We've come to draw. Hallelujah. Shade, God is saying, I should tell you, tell your husband is the season for him to rise. I'm seeing your husband by the end of this month entering a level of strange breakthrough. Strange breakthrough. Strange breakthrough. This is what I'm seeing. Strange breakthrough that God is bringing for him. Strange breakthrough that God is bringing for him. Strange breakthrough. There is a man of God here. I don't know who that person is, but I'm seeing a strange grace for healing coming on a man of God. There is someone, I don't know where, but may the Spirit of God find that person now. A strange anointing for healing. You will see dimensions of healing miracles happen in your life and ministry in a way that will surprise you. Strange operations of the Spirit. Hallelujah. The Lord is showing me a very strange vision. I'm seeing people running. I'm seeing a rope. I'm seeing them running. When they're about to jump a fence, the rope pulls them down. This is what I'm seeing. It will not stop you for provided you are inside the place. But to jump the fence, the rope stops you. Where are they, oh God? I cut that rope. I release you. Break those boundaries. What stop your father? What stop your mother? I command that it will not stop you. Shakatatata. Reketete koto sheketa. Reketa lava shupasia. Raposho to seketiata. In the mighty name of Jesus, I decree. An end comes to it tonight by the oppression of the spirit. Limitations are breaking. Sisters, ladies, limitations are breaking. Tribal limitations, territorial limitations, I command you to break now. Hallelujah. We'll soon round up. Am I wasting your time? I'm seeing a vision, and I'm seeing many people with bodies but no heads, no faces. Every time I see this, that means someone's glory has been covered. This is what the Lord, when I see those kinds of, they come in different forms, but because you see, the head of a man, not just the hair, represents the center of glory. When you see a human being walking and no head, there is no structure, there is no, I don't know how to pray this prayer now, but I need to pray for somebody. I don't know what has come. You are alive. You will pass your destiny helper. He will act like he's not seeing you. There's something covering it. It's not normal. It's not normal. It doesn't take so much for men to help you. But brothers and sisters, when it is covered, you can remain there forever. Buy an instrument and cover it. It is still as good as you don't have it. Because until it is opened, I don't know what has stopped you from appearing. No job, no increase, no promotion, no joy, no peace. When people want to help you, something happens. Some of us here, the suffering you are suffering is not supposed to be. What has covered you? In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God, I decree and I declare to you tonight, by the power that raised Christ from the dead, Sheketoko Soto Pakata Rakatosia Lekepraska Dabarianda Sudopakatia. I command that embargo. Many of you will feel like fire on your face, literally like fire on your face. There is a veil that is being torn. I tear that veil right now. Please help them. I tear that veil right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I declare to you, arise and shine. Arise and shine. I prophesy it. Arise and shine. Arise and shine. Arise and shine. Arise and shine. Listen. When the word of God comes like this, before you believe a man, find out his track record. Don't waste your time believing something that does not work. The Bible says we have not taught you cunningly devised fables. Let me tell you the truth. God has given me a grace for performance. There is nobody I speak to over a thing except he did not believe it. It will come to pass, no matter what it is. God gave me the revelation. It's called the key of David. You can open a door and a spirit will shut it. But he said, I am he that was dead but now is alive, and I hold the key of David. And he can open a door that no man, the only person that can shut it is the one who opened it. When I got that revelation, because I can speak over people and something will happen and the devil will shut it back. The key of David is a real key, access to open possibilities and Elisha had it. He opened a man's eyes at once and said, look at them. You see, what makes men great is not their bodies, but the mysteries. The mysteries. Mysteries are like portals. They open you to possibilities. So these things don't just have, it's not just anointing. No, this is more than anointing. Every closed door over anyone's life here, in the name of Jesus Christ, the God of heaven, the revealer of secrets and mysteries, I command that door to open and remain open. Open and remain open. Open and remain open. In the name of Jesus Christ. The kind of favor you have never seen in your life. May the God I serve release that favor on your life. In the name of Jesus Christ, release that favor on your life. Let me round up with this last impartation. Open your heart to receive. Romans chapter 1 verse 11. For I long to see you. It is my desire to see you. Why? To the end that I may impart upon you some spiritual gift. One of the ways that we receive spiritual gift is through impartation. Impartation is a transference of possibilities. It's not a transference of anointing necessarily. It's a transference of possibilities. A dimension that was not captured in your walk with God. There is by the supply of the Spirit an opening of that portal, that vista, that dimension. That's what you are about to receive now. I want you to receive with all your heart. In the name of Jesus, I'm seeing water rising from the ground. And the Lord is saying, this is how the impartation will come. Like water from the ground rising. And I'm seeing Ezekiel 47, the river. I decree and I declare right now, at the count of three, oh Lord, inside overflow, 1, 2, 3, and all those connected from all the 47 nations of the world, I decree and declare right now, in the name of Jesus, let there be a baptism of the gifts of the Spirit upon your life. Receive it right now. Receive it right now. The word of wisdom, strange order of wisdom, the word of knowledge, I release it upon you right now. Discerning of spirits, receive it in the name of Jesus. Receive it in the name of Jesus. The gift of diverse kinds of tongues. And if you are here, you are not filled with the Holy Ghost, as I speak right now, I stretch my hands. May the power of the highest come upon you now. I command utterances, utterances, tongues of men, tongues of angels, tongues of men, tongues of angels, in the name of Jesus. I decree and declare, receive the gift of prophecy. The eyes that see and the ears that hear, I release it now. I release it now. I stretch my hands and I release upon you the gift of faith, supernatural faith. Receive it right now. It's coming like fire on someone's hand. Receive the gift of faith. Audacious ability. Audacious ability. Go and do the impossible. Say the impossible. Accomplish the impossible. I decree and declare, this will come on many people. The gifts of healing, we need it. We need it. In the name of Jesus, especially many ladies, this is a dispensation where God will be using a lot of ladies in the healing ministry.
Receive that grace right now. The healing anointing, gift of healing, strange healing, healing of cancers, healing of HIV, diabetes. Lay your hands, command the devils to go. Is the ability to declare things on bodies, on nature, whatever, manipulate possibilities to square up with the divine counsel of God. I release that gift upon your life. The working of miracles. You will speak over impossible situations. You will watch them turn around. It will start with your academics. It will start with your job. It will start with your family. In the name of Jesus, things that should not happen, make them happen. Make them happen. Things that should never have happened, I empower you to make them happen. In the name of Jesus. Clear the aisles for them, please. Wherever you are, inside, outside, make your way to the front quickly. Don't wait for anybody to come. Be the first. Come happily, come cheerfully. Let's honor them. God bless you. Someone is running to Jesus. Overflow. 1, 2, 3. Please run quickly. Clear the way for them. Don't say I'm ashamed. No. Come. If you're coming, please run. Double up quickly. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. He said, in that day, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. You can choose to harden your heart and go back. But someone is saying, I'm tired of the way things are in my life. I'm running to Jesus. Koinonia, let's honor them as they come. Let's honor them as they come. We present to you Jesus Christ, the destiny changer. We present to you Jesus Christ, the one who can lift a man out from a dunghill. Keep coming. God bless you. I believe there are still some more people. You're saying, Apostle, I'm not sure if I'm born again or not. Come and join them. Come and join them quickly. Mommy, God bless you. Come and join them quickly. Join them quickly. I'm not sure. I don't know whether I'm born again or not. I just know I've always been to church. No, sir. Ye must be born again. Join them quickly. If you're coming from outside, please run. I'm about to pray. Lead the people to pray. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Some of you are crying. Don't be ashamed of your tears. When you stand before Jesus, his loving arms will reach out to you and he gives you a new beginning. The Bible says to remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. I want to lead you. It's a simple prayer. It's more than a recitation. It's a prayer that you are engaging your faith with and you are trusting that the Spirit of God himself will confirm it. If that gentleman is joining them, please double up. Just come quickly. Hallelujah. I'd like you to say this after me sincerely, truthfully, and passionately. Say, Lord Jesus. Say it again. Say, Lord Jesus. I love you. I've experienced your presence tonight. And I declare that I'm a sinner in need of your love, in need of your mercy, in need of your life. Tonight, I make Jesus Lord of my life, genuinely, truthfully, sincerely. I declare that the life of God is in my spirit right now. I believe that Jesus is my Savior. I believe that Jesus is my Lord. From today, I receive the power to live for Jesus and to live a victorious life. In the name of Jesus. Let me pray for you. Jesus, we present to you the ones you died for. It was for them, alongside all of us, that you were at the cross. I pray in the name of Jesus that the Spirit of God, our seal of redemption, that he will seal these ones and impart the life and the glory of God in their lives. I declare your sins forgiven. I decree and declare that God gives you a new beginning from tonight. In the name of Jesus. The grace that makes for a victorious life, we release it upon you. The love of God, love for God, hunger for the things of the kingdom, we release it upon you. I declare that the past, the memory and the effects leave like smoke before the wind. In the name of Jesus. And the Lord gives you a new beginning. From today, you move forward ever and backward never. In Jesus' name. Thank you so much for making this
most noble decision. I want you to follow the gentleman waving his hands. He will, they will get a few details and communicate to you very briefly, and you'll be back to your seat. Thank you so much. I love all of you. God bless you. Let's honor them quickly.